The Committee on Homeland Security will come to order. The committee is meeting today to receive testimony on confronting the rise of domestic terrorism in the homeland. Good morning. This issue of domestic terrorism is not new. In fact, Democrats on the committee have been following this issue for years. Over the last 8 years, Democratic members of this committee have sent request after request asking for then Republican majority to hold hearings on domestic terrorism in the homeland. Each and every request was either ignored or denied. I'm looking forward under my leadership and the ranking members' leadership to address any problem that we might see in the homeland or internationally. So we want to address terrorism wherever we find it. Instead, the victims and survivors of domestic terrorist attack, time and time again, have been offered moments of silence and prayers rather than congressional actions. For those of you in the hearing room, when you see the monitor screens, are the images and headlines of the domestic terrorist attacks that have been torn through our nation while the Republicans were in charge of this committee and the House of Representatives. To all the victims, survivors, and communities who have felt like the terror you suffered was ignored or minimized, know that it ends with today's hearing. Today is a new day, and this committee's silence on domestic terrorism now ends. Because in recent years, we've seen a dramatic and disturbing rise in domestic terrorism, particularly far-right extremist violence tied to white supremacist extremism and white nationalism. The few pieces of government data that we've seen confirm that domestic terrorism is an urgent and growing threat to the homeland. In the last 2 years, there have been more domestic terrorism-related arrests than international terrorist-related arrests. Last year, nearly all extremism-related murders in the United States were committed by right-wing domestic terrorists. Of course, we only need to look at the news to know that this is a serious problem. Just 2 weeks ago, a domestic terrorist attacked Jewish worshipers at a synagogue near San Diego, killing one woman. In February, a former Coast Guard lieutenant was indicted after stockpiling weapons and drugs, planning attack targeting prominent Democratic politicians, including a member of this committee, Congresswoman Jackson Lee. Last October, a domestic terrorist killed 11 Jewish worshipers at a synagogue in Pittsburgh. That same month, a domestic terrorist sent pipe bombs to domestic politicians all across the country. And that is just in the last few months. From Charleston to Oak Creek to Charlottesville to Garden City, we've seen these violent ideologies rear their ugly heads over and over. Unfortunately, President Trump has tried to play both sides with domestic terrorism. On April 26, 2019, President Trump doubled down on his stance that there were fine people on both sides of the August 2017 Unite the Right rally in Charlottesville, Virginia. His unwillingness to denounce and distance himself from these extremists has been taken by many as tacit support. The president and all of us must be willing to stand up to all ideologically motivated violence in America. Unfortunately, far-right extremism is not limited to the United States. It is evolving into a global phenomenon. Earlier this year, the terrorist who killed 50 people and wounded 50 more at two mosques in New Zealand wrote that he was inspired by American and European far-right extremists. It is well past time to take action. But in order to really get a handle on this evolving threat, we need to understand it. The lack of public information on domestic terrorism coming out of the federal agencies is nothing short of alarming. What is the nature of the threat, and what is the government doing about it? This hearing is the first step toward transparency, but there is much more information we need. That is why I'm developing legislation to require the federal government to regularly and publicly report data on domestic terrorism. I'm optimistic that it will become a bipartisan effort. Finally, I want to welcome our witnesses from the Department of Justice, Federal Bureau of Investigation, and Department of Homeland Security. I look forward to your testimony, but I want to be clear about my frustration with your agencies. After the attack on mosque in New Zealand, I asked to speak to Director Wray about domestic terrorism. To date, the FBI director has not made himself available for a conversation. In early April, during a classified briefing on domestic terrorism, members of this committee asked you for several follow-up items and get-backs. My staff followed up many times over the last month. We only received get-backs from FBI on Monday night. We received incomplete get-backs from INA last night. It has been more than a month. In fact, while all of the witnesses have known about this hearing and topic since April 3rd, more than a month ago, we received all your testimony late yesterday evening, mere hours before this hearing. Further, despite a decade-long history of bipartisan briefing on threats to our nation, including domestic threats, threats from the international terrorist organization, and counterintelligence threats, the FBI decided to stop briefing this committee on a monthly basis after the Democrats took the majority. Stonewalling this committee in our efforts to carry out our constitutional oversight duties is unacceptable. I urge the Justice Department, the FBI, and the Department of Homeland Security to recommit to working with this committee on behalf of the American people. With that, I now recognize the ranking member of the full committee, the gentleman from Alabama, Mr. Rogers, for an opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank the chairman for calling this important hearing today. I condemn all acts of violence. I condemn all acts of violence done in the name of disturbed political, racial, or religious ideologies. I know every member of this committee agrees with me, and to imply otherwise is inaccurate. Today's hearing is important. We must use this opportunity to have a meaningful discussion and learn how we as Congress can help root out evil in our society. I sincerely hope this hearing isn't used for political grandstanding. A YouTube clip won't solve these problems, but a serious discussion with serious people can help inform how Congress and this committee can act. As members of this committee know, acts of domestic terrorism are not a new phenomenon. Throughout our history, deeply disturbed individuals have resorted to violence to avenge real or imagined grievances. What has changed is that almost 20 years ago, terrorists attacked four planes and murdered nearly 3,000 Americans. Since then, Americans have awoken to the threat of foreign terror organizations, but have not fully understood the influence they have on our society. Bad actors in our country have adopted strategies from foreign terrorist organizations. Terrorists at home are learning from terrorists abroad. The pervasiveness of the internet and social media have made connecting extremists fast, free, and anonymous. Movements preaching violence have found new homes and broader audiences online. The same tools that allow us to communicate globally are allowing networks of radicals to connect once isolated fringe groups. The recent wave of attacks targeting religious institutions has inspired and amplified by social media and fringe websites. Fringe websites have become havens for the most abhorrent behavior in our societies. A quick search yields hundreds of results from the most disturbing and hateful ideologies ever written. These searches lead to communities built around hate, conspiracy theories, and most worryingly, images of graphic murder and suicide. These are not Facebook or Twitter. These fringe sites house videos of terrorist propaganda, shooter manifestos, and gory content alongside fresh calls for violence. Many post or dares to commit violence or suicide. Others respond with ideas of how to carry out violence. This image, which has been edited, and you can see on the TV monitors, promoting the killers, was recently shared in response to a post about a terrorist attack. It lists the attackers, alleged ideology, photo, and name. The list then awards points to mass shooters, terrorists, and murderers. Points are provided for each killer, each person killed, a killer's mental status, killing cops, and if the attacker killed himself. These images and their vile call to action create a vortex of despair and viciousness. This sinister force is clearly capturing the minds of troubled people at a greater rate than ever before. This is not a single surefire way to stop violence before it occurs, but there are steps we can take to reduce future violence. Working with industry and law enforcement, we can build a comprehensive strategy to detect, monitor, and disrupt online fronts for terror and violence. We must expand outreach to communities and educate them about the radicalization process and find ways to help troubled individuals early enough to stop their attacks. We must continue to encourage individuals to say something to law enforcement if they ever see or hear something suspicious. And finally, we must encourage the state and local enforcement, law enforcement, to continue their participation in the FBI's Joint Terrorism Task Force program and state and local fusion centers. Both initiatives bring state and local law enforcement together with federal law enforcement to share intelligence and leverage authorities to counter threats, including domestic terrorism. Now is not the time for cities to withdraw from the programs to score petty political points. I look forward to working with the chairman and our colleagues on the Judiciary Committee on ways to end the scourge of domestic terrorism, and I yield back.
Thank you. Other members of the committee are reminded that under the committee rules, opening statements may be submitted for the record. I now welcome the first panel of witnesses in our only panel to this hearing. Without objection, the witness's full statement will be inserted in the record. And let me introduce for the committee members panel. Our first witness is Mr. Brad Wiggleman, who currently serves as Deputy Assistant Attorney General for the National Department of Justice. Prior to joining the Department of Justice, Mr. Wiggleman has had a career government attorney for the past 20 years. Our next witness is Mr. Michael McGarrity, who currently serves as the Assistant Director of Counterterrorism for the Federal Bureau of Investigation. Prior to joining the Counterterrorism Division, Mr. McGarrity most recently served as a special agent in charge of the Criminal Division of the New York Field Office. Finally, we're joined by Mr. Brian Murphy, who currently serves as the Principal Deputy Undersecretary for Intelligence and Analysis with the Department of Homeland Security. Prior to this election, Mr. Murphy served as the Acting Principal Deputy for Intelligence and Analysis. I thank you, gentlemen, for agreeing, and I remind each witness that you have 5 minutes for your statement, Mr. Wiggleman.
Thank you, Chairman Thompson, Ranking Member Rogers, members of the committee. Thanks for the opportunity to testify on behalf of the Department of Justice. Protecting the American people from terrorism and other national security threats has long been the top priority of the department. Domestic terrorism continues to pose a serious threat to the public, as a number of recent attacks and plots demonstrate. We've seen individuals conduct attacks far too many times, whether motivated by anti-government animus, racism, or other ideologies. Regardless of the motivation, our goals at DOJ are to prevent such attacks and to bring those responsible to justice. This morning, I'd like to give you just a brief overview of how the Department of Justice is organized to handle domestic terrorism cases and the legal authorities on which we rely. On the front lines are our 94 U.S. Attorney's offices. Each office coordinates a group of federal, state, and local law enforcement in the district called the Anti-Terrorism Advisory Council, or ATAC. The ATAC works in close partnership with its corresponding FBI Joint Terrorism Task Force. The ATACs promote training and information sharing among federal, state, and local law enforcement. Each U.S. Attorney's office also has designated a senior prosecutor to serve as the ATAC coordinator. This designee is specially trained and serves as the lead counterterrorism prosecutor for the district. Many offices have also designated national security sections that focus on counterterrorism and other national security threats. At Main Justice here in Washington, the National Security Division was created in 2006 to integrate the department's counterterrorism and other national security work nationwide. We have a counterterrorism section with more than 40 attorneys, all of whom are equipped to work on both domestic and international terrorism. We also have a Council for Domestic Terrorism and two domestic terrorism coordinators. NSD attorneys are notified and available to provide assistance when any domestic terrorism investigation or prosecution is initiated. In addition, other divisions of the department play an important role. For example, the Civil Rights Division is responsible for overseeing the prosecution of hate crimes, some of which may also qualify as acts of domestic terrorism. Finally, we have a Domestic Terrorism Executive Committee, which reports to the Attorney General. This committee is not operational, but provides a national level forum for information sharing on domestic terrorism matters. Turning quickly to our legal authorities, we have prosecuted domestic terrorists using a wide range of criminal statutes. These include weapons and explosive charges, threat, hoax, or riot charges, and charges prescribing attacks on federal officials or facilities. As I mentioned, hate crimes charges may also be appropriate where conduct is motivated by biases against a race, religion, or ethnicity. It is also a crime to knowingly provide material support or resources in support of certain offenses designated as terrorism-related. We also work closely with our state and local partners to confront domestic terrorism. Some cases don't involve violations of federal law, but are prosecuted under state law. Other cases may involve violations of both federal and state law, and the state charge may, in some cases, be the most effective way to prosecute. In those circumstances, we support our state and local partners where we can. Now, the criminal code also includes a definition of domestic terrorism and federal crime of terrorism. These definitions provide us with an array of expanded investigative tools and sentencing enhancements in domestic terrorism matters. So, for example, judges can issue nationwide search warrants. Government attorneys have additional authority to share grand jury information. Congress has also created a rebuttable presumption of pretrial detention for offenses that are listed as federal crimes of terrorism. And then the sentencing guidelines then provide a significant sentencing enhancement for these offenses. In my written testimony, I've provided a number of examples of recent domestic terrorism cases that we have brought. In many of these cases, we've worked with FBI to arrest and charge the individuals before violence occurred. Consistent with longstanding department policy, our practice is always to charge and pursue the most serious, readily provable offense available based on the facts of the case. It's important to emphasize that we prosecute domestic terrorists for their criminal acts, not for their beliefs or based on their associations. In fighting domestic terrorism, we respect the constitutional rights of freedom of speech, association, and assembly of all Americans. The FBI may not investigate solely on the basis of First Amendment protected activity. With that, I'll close, and I appreciate the opportunity to discuss these issues today, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you very much. Chair now recognizes Mr. McGarrity.
Good morning, Chairman Thompson, Ranking Member Rogers, and members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today. As Chairman Thompson mentioned earlier, my name is Michael McGarrity, and I'm the Assistant Director of the FBI's Counterterrorism Division. I have the unique honor and privilege to represent all the men and women that work counterterrorism with the FBI and our joint terrorism task forces around the nation. I will be providing an overview of the FBI's efforts to counter domestic terrorism by explaining what we do and how we do it. The FBI is the lead federal agency for investigating terrorism. The FBI categorizes terrorism investigations into two main categories, international terrorism and domestic terrorism. International terrorists include members of designated foreign terrorist organizations, FTOs, state sponsors of terrorism, and homegrown violent extremists, or HVEs. Domestic terrorists are individuals who commit violent criminal acts in furtherance of ideological goals stemming from domestic influences such as racial bias and anti-government sentiment. Despite the many similarities, the FBI distinguishes domestic terrorism extremists from homegrown violent extremists in that the latter are global jihad inspired, while domestic terrorists' inspiration emanates from domestic influences like racial bias or anti-authority. The FBI organizes domestic terrorism into four categories. First, racially motivated violent extremism is defined by the FBI as threats derived from bias relating to race held by the actor against others. These threats are often directed at religious or racial minorities. Anti-government, anti-authority extremism is defined as threats advocating for ideology contrary to established government systems, such as anarchist extremism, militia extremism, and sovereign citizen extremism. Third, animal rights environmental extremism is defined as threats derived from a belief that criminal actions are necessary to end cruelty and exploitation of animals and the environment. And the fourth, abortion extremism is defined as threats derived from both pro-life and pro-choice individuals who seek to advance their social and political agenda, wholly or in part, through the force of violence or in violation of federal law. Though domestic terrorism activity may fall outside of these four categories, the vast majority of our investigations can be characterized as one of the above. Domestic terrorism, as previously stated, is defined by federal statute 18 U.S.C. 2331, Section 5. It's important to note that no investigation can be opened based solely on First Amendment-protected activity. This includes hateful rhetoric and participation in rallies and protests. The FBI assesses domestic terrorists collectively pose a persistent and evolving threat of violence and economic harm to the United States. In fact, there have been more arrests and deaths in the United States caused by domestic terrorists than international terrorists in recent years. Individuals affiliated with racially motivated violent extremism are responsible for the most lethal and violent activity. Racially motivated violent extremists are responsible for the majority of lethal attacks and fatalities perpetrated by domestic terrorists since 2000. Tactics and trends within individual movements continue to evolve, but most drivers for domestic terrorists remain constant. These include perceptions of government or law enforcement overreach, racial tensions, socio-political conditions, and reactions to legislation. Radicalization of domestic terrorists primarily occurs through self-radicalization online, which can sometimes present mitigation difficulties for law enforcement to identify, detect, and disrupt. The internet and social media enables individuals to engage other domestic terrorists without face-to-face meetings. We have seen devastating attacks committed by domestic terrorists in recent months. Most recently, the shootings in the synagogue in California and a synagogue in Pennsylvania. In 2018, domestic violent extremists conducted 6 lethal attacks, killing 17 victims. In 2017, domestic violent extremists conducted 5 lethal attacks, killing 8 victims. Central to our effort to combat terror attacks is the Joint Terrorism Task Force model. We work hand in hand with federal, state, and local agencies to effectively combat the threat. In fact, 50% of our domestic terrorism investigations are open based upon information received from either the public or from referrals from our partners on the federal, state, and local side. Despite successes that result from the hard work of men and women of the FBI, our JTTFs and our partners across the government, domestic terrorism continues to pose a persistent threat to the homeland. We currently have 850 predicated domestic terrorism investigations. And as we just saw a few weeks ago in California, the threat of domestic terrorism exists in every region of the United States and affects all walks of life. Our commitment to you and to our fellow citizens is that we will continue to confront the threat posed by domestic terrorists with determination and dedication to our mission to protect the American people and uphold the Constitution of the United States. Thank you again for the opportunity to appear before you today. The men and women of the FBI are grateful for the support that you have provided us and continue to provide. I look forward to answering any questions you might have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Chair now recognizes for 5 minutes, Mr. Murphy.
Thank you, Chairman Thompson, Ranking Member Rogers, and members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to present to you today the DHS Intelligence Enterprise efforts to ensure that all forms of violence that are threats to the Homeland Security are being addressed. I can assure the committee and the American public that throughout the careful calculus of balancing resources and adapting to an ever-changing threat landscape, DHS remains acutely focused on the threat from domestic terrorism. The domestic terrorism threat to the homeland may come from a diverse range of movements, as you've heard from my FBI colleagues. And as described before, the lone actors from those movements subscribing to these ideologies pose the greatest threat to the homeland due to their ability, in many instances, to remain undetected by law enforcement until operational, and their general willingness to attack soft targets with simple weapons. The DHS Intelligence Enterprise constantly evaluates how to improve our ability to provide information and intelligence to a wide array of partners as fast as we can, and that complement U.S. government efforts to combat all threats to the homeland, and ensuring at the same time that our finite resources are best aligned and not being applied in a manner that duplicates the efforts of our partners. To that end, in 2018, the Department established mission centers to drive the integration of intelligence across the DHS enterprise and look at threat streams as they come at us, and this includes counterterrorism. My testimony today will outline the holistic and agile manner in which we continue to apply resources against a serious threat of domestic terrorism while avoiding unnecessary duplications. The importance of an integrated and collaborative approach cannot be understated in today's CT environment as we enter the post-September 11th era, and CT investments across the government are being reconsidered and in some cases reallocated against developing threat streams such as foreign influence, cybersecurity, and transnational organized crime. Of note, CT practitioners across the government recognize that the threat from CT is not going away. The ability to execute this demanding mission remains the same, and the future of CT efforts are based on efficient interagency modeling. Historically, as noted by the FBI and Department of Justice, the FBI has been well positioned to produce intelligence on domestic terrorism and hate crimes. They are the lead for the United States government on domestic terrorism and hate crimes investigations, and the FBI owns a preponderance of the information and resources to support these investigations and analysis. For that reason, DHS domestic terrorism-related intelligence production was sometimes viewed as duplicative as we relied on the data from our colleagues. We have now transitioned to a more active intelligence phase and are producing more original and unique reporting. As part of our establishment of mission centers, we now have a 24/7 open source collection team, which was established to identify potential threat intelligence. Due to this shift, the DHS intelligence enterprise increased open source collection and reporting on domestic terrorism. As a result, our increase in production has risen by 40% on this issue since last fiscal year. We have done this and still kept our finished intelligence products consistent since 2014. Overall, I believe FY18 represents the highest level of production ever achieved by the department in the domestic terrorism context. Additionally, the number of personnel assigned and supporting the domestic terrorism portfolio has substantially increased. For example, we maintain a robust presence in the field that engages with all our state and local partners. They're forward deployed at fusion centers and among our police colleagues and work on JTTFs throughout the country. Additionally, through the Homeland Security Information Exchange, or as I will call HIS and Intel, we enable the sharing of products and information between all levels of government. HIS and Intel is utilized by over 4,000 professionals across the country and includes over 40,000 products on a range of Homeland Security threat issues. That includes domestic terrorism. Since 2016, we have increased that number of products by approximately 64% of the number of products shared. We measure the effectiveness of these products, and in fiscal years 2017 and 2018, we saw a 325% increase in terms of how these products are and how often they're being viewed. Additionally, feedback from the products we post receive above 90% in terms of how they are viewed and their usefulness to our partners. Lastly, we have recently announced internal intelligence enterprise to realign our efforts, and we are introducing a new program to enhance the reporting of tips and leads, partnership with our colleagues here regarding potential mass shooting casualty events linked to terrorism and other incidents. Lastly, I appreciate the opportunity to appear before you today and represent the men and women of DHS, pending your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I thank the witnesses for their testimony. I remind each member that he or she will have 5 minutes to question the panel. I now recognize myself for questions. One of the reasons for having this hearing is since 2005, we've not had the production of domestic terrorism data available, not just to this committee, but to the public. And so what we're trying to do is get, from an informational standpoint, what's out here. And from what I've heard from the witness today, it's been very good in terms of what you know. One of the things I want to do as a takeaway from this hearing, as I indicated in my opening statement, is to make sure that if it's a resource issue for the department that you can't produce this information, then we need to make those resources, now I'm talking to Mr. McGarrett, in terms of the FBI providing that data. Because for members of this committee, we need to understand what the threat is, if it's changing, and those kind of things. So I thank you for that information. One of the more looming comments you made is that there are some 850 investigations underway. You know, that tells me you're doing your job. But as important is this: the history of this committee is we've always had access to this information, some of it in a classified setting for over 10 years. And the department now has pulled back on that And I'm indicating that we would still like to have the briefings on a monthly basis from the department on these and any other areas that you think might be beneficial to us, but not to have the this information doesn't allow us the full breadth of what we need. And some of the members have been on the committee and have participated in the briefings, and they've been very helpful. And so we're going to renew that effort to try to get you to the briefings to share that information with the committee. Now, the last briefing we did have, we asked for certain information. It was over 5 weeks ago, and we just got it yesterday. That's too long. And we need to work out a process that when there are get-backs relative to whatever, those get-backs come within a reasonable period of time. And we're not asking for information that's not currently available. So if you can assure the committee, to the extent practicable, Mr. McGarrity, that on that kind of data, you will make it available to us, I would appreciate it.
Chairman, just first, as far as what we did provide that you received on Monday, please take a look at it, and if certainly open to a conversation as to the details that we are giving and if that's helpful or not. So certainly my commitment is to make that product and see if there's anything else that would be beneficial. As far as the monthly briefings, certainly working with our Congressional Affairs Office and the Department of Justice to have that dialogue, you know, we'll continue to do that to see if that's appropriate.
Thank you very much. Mr. Wigman, thank you for the prosecutions that you all have generated over time. Are there any resources identified or you lack to continue to pursue those prosecutions?
No, sir, not at this time.
Can you share the demographics of the prosecutions with the committee?
Share information concerning the cases that we bring? Is that?
Yes.
Sure. Yes, we can. Consistent with, you know, if there are cases under seal, and obviously there can be exceptions about what type of information we can share, but absolutely we could share information about the cases that we've brought.
So I'm really talking about the cases that you've prosecuted, not the ones that you're looking to prosecute.
That's right. Our charges are public, and
sure.
So we can make those.
Can you make that available to us?
We can.
Sure. So, Mr. McGarrity, let me again compliment what you do on providing this information. But one of the challenges we have is the changing of the threat landscape. When we first started as and I would reaffirm the committee's interest in having access to that kind of information. So if there are some policy changes we need to implement, we can have access to that data in a reasonable period of time. And again, I'm going to do the legislation to provide the resources to help the department produce that legislation, that information that you used to do. Up until 2005. But I just a comment. I yield to the ranking member for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Trump administration released an updated national strategy for counterterrorism in October of last year, and for the first time, the strategy includes domestic terrorism. How significant is the inclusion of domestic terrorism in the national strategy for counterterrorism? Mr. McGarrity?
Sure. I've been working this, obviously, since 9/11. It's the first time I'm aware that domestic terrorism is included in the national security strategy.
And what does that mean for you?
What is that? So from that point, first, it's in there. So whatever we talk about, I think everyone would agree it's what we're focused on, right? So we're highlighting that there is a domestic terrorism threat, that it's persistent. In fact, the strategy actually calls out that domestic terrorism, notably, is on the rise. What we are seeing, and we've seen it on the international terrorism side, and we're seeing it on the domestic terrorism side, we are seeing an evolution of the threat from what we perceived the threat used to be. What I mean by that, on the international terrorism side, we certainly still have Al-Qaeda, AQAP, ISIS. What we have and we've seen in the last 4 to 5 years is the homegrown violent extremist threat where someone can get on the internet and self-radicalize. We are seeing that same type threat in the domestic terrorism world where individual actors, lone wolves, insular type people can find their ideology to justify their violence and their actions online. So we're actually seeing similar type threats within the homeland that we frankly have not seen in this regard if you look 20 years ago, and part of that's due to the internet, to be able to come radicalized fairly quickly and immobilized to that violence quickly. We're seeing it both on the international terrorism side with our HVEs and our domestic terrorism lone actors.
Yeah, you made that point, you weren't seeing it 20 years ago. When did you start seeing this phenomenon occur where they were adopting, domestic terrorists were adopting the techniques of international terrorists to radicalize people? Was it 5 years ago, 10 years ago? When do you think that started occurring? Because it's really a relatively recent phenomenon, or it seems to me.
I would just put it with the internet, sir, and social media, the ability to people all over the world to communicate without actually doing face-to-face meetings. So that same that we saw on the HVE side, we're seeing on the domestic terrorism side. I wouldn't say they're necessarily copying international terrorists and HVEs. I think they're just seeing the same platform and the medium that they can use to exploit and gain information that fits their ideology to pursue violence.
Okay. Do you have any recommendations for what can be done to address the viral hate speech and incitement of violence found on fringe sites like 8chan and Gab? And that's for any of you. Y'all don't have any suggestions for us? That's scary.
Sir, sir, I would add
we can't make policy without good advisement.
I would just add, within the department, we actively pursue forums that are available to the public where we see potential acts of violence, and we're continuing to refine that and get better at it. We operate in, obviously, within the corners of our civil rights, civil liberty, and privacy efforts, but those efforts are increasing. And that was one of the things in the written statements that we provided, as well as in my testimony today. Our numbers bear that out, that we continue to look at those areas where the domestic terrorism and other forms of violence aggregate and talk among themselves and spot and identify those. And we in the department then provide that to the JTTF, state and locals, for enforcement if appropriate.
Well, there has to be some point at which your right to free speech ends when you start threatening violence, particularly in a mass setting. So I think there's a place for policy to be implemented that can be helpful. And I do urge y'all to be thinking about what we can do to help you do your job more effectively. Now you'll back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. Chair recognizes the young lady from New Mexico, Ms. Torres Small.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you all for being here. As you know, recently there's been an uptick in attacks against nonprofit institutions, specifically faith-based organizations. These types of institutions are eligible for federal funding to improve their physical security through FEMA's nonprofit security grant program. And that's important. For example, my church back home recently did a safety and security assessment, only to find that there were a lot of needs and no money to help fill those needs. The problem exists, however, where institutions located outside of urban area security initiative jurisdictions, which traditionally have less resources and are unprepared for an attack, usually have less access to federal funds. That's why I was proud to support Chairman Thompson's recently introduced bipartisan legislation that would increase federal funding for organizations outside of UWASI jurisdictions, like many of the rural nonprofit organizations in New Mexico. Aside from federal funding, information sharing between intelligence agencies and local law enforcement is essential to keep our communities safe. Can you all please speak on how your respective agencies share information with law enforcement, houses of worship, and community centers, specifically in rural locations?
Thank you. Good questions. And certainly something we've been actively engaged on, certainly over the last couple years. We rely on the Joint Terrorism Task Force model, obviously, to work with our state, local, federal partners and our tribal partners as well. That mechanism, when you have two officers, task force officers and agents, sitting with our analysts in the field in the local community, is the best way to move the information quickly. And we'll also do the same with our fusion cells. How we move information out to the state and local partners, specifically if threats or after an attack occurs, is through our joint intelligence bulletins. And these are bulletins we go out, and we go out from the FBI, we do it jointly, dual sealed with the Department of Homeland Security, and we push them out. So in the last year, in fiscal year 2018, we had an increase, certainly from the year before. And in 2019, we are certainly well above where we were in 2018 in putting out these joint intelligence bulletins that go to state and local partners and infusion cells. Specifically as to the faith-based organizations, I can tell you, Mr. Murphy and I have been on several calls with our religious security officials set up either through DHS, where they're sponsoring the call, or the FBI, where we get on the call, specifically after an attack, and we'll walk through different things on what we've seen, if there's any intelligence that's out there. And we've done that. We rely on our partnerships. The FBI send both locally through our special agent in charge and the Joint Terrorism Task Force, working with our local police, state locals, to go out to the religious community and make sure we're engaged with them at the local level. Because even though there are national threats, the local threat on the domestic terrorism is where it's going to percolate, and we'll have to address that. And then just in a more broad sense, where we hit the chiefs of police, the International Association Chiefs of Police, the major city sheriffs, I personally have briefed them and will continue to do that every year through our FBI partner engagement, which when we do that, we set that up. They all come and we give them threat briefings on domestic terrorism, on international terrorism, and we talk about specific threats and cases. And we absolutely have talked about domestic terrorism in the last year with the major city chiefs.
If anyone else is going to contribute, can you also just specifically address anything different that you do in rural communities who are sometimes harder to reach?
Yes, ma'am. As we speak right now, we have an effort ongoing to complement the intelligence networks of rural sheriffs to combat the threats. New Mexico is a part of that campaign. It is not specifically designed to combat domestic terrorism, but rather look at all threats that the rural counties are facing. So we have several efforts like that that we traditionally do, and we just happen to be in the middle of one of them.
Just my last question, how can we improve the security of rural nonprofit organizations, which often don't have the extensive resources for robust security systems?
Well, I'm not going to speak to grant money or anything, but certainly engagement with our joint terrorism task forces, wherever. And when I said that, I said state, local, as well as tribal partners. So when we do that, obviously, engagement with the Joint Terrorism Task Force to make sure there is a dialogue going on. We push threat information out to our 56 field offices through the over 200 joint terrorism task forces across the U.S. to push that information out. We just got to make sure there's a dialogue at the local level.
Yes, ma'am. I'd add one other thing. The department does a lot of effort, as well as DOJ does, with the faith-based community. One thing that I would bring out as a possibility is connecting with these groups, rural, urban, whatever, is always an ongoing effort and challenge. So anything we can do to partner with members of Congress to improve that, we're happy to engage in.
Thank you.
Thank you. Chair now recognizes the gentleman from New York, Mr. King.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. At the outset, let me take strong exception to your opening statement. The inference in there was that somehow members of this committee were not concerned about terror attacks carried out by groups like white nationalists, Nazis, whatever. And that is rewriting history. First of all, I've just put on the record that my recollection is during the 4 years you were chairman, you never had one of those hearings either. Secondly, at all the hearings, I know I was chairman for 2 years and then 4 years later on, there was every year there's at least one hearing on terror threats. I don't recall you bringing any witnesses at all to talk about domestic terrorism. And let's go back to the start of this. This committee was formed after the Department of Homeland Security was formed because we've always had terror groups in this country, Ku Klux Klan, American Nazi Party, Weather Underground, Animal Rights League. In the early 1970s, we had more than 65 NYPD cops killed in the line of duty. There's always been a form of domestic terrorism. This Department of Homeland Security was formed in probably the greatest faced the largest reorganization of our government in history because of the magnitude of the attack on 9/11 and because we saw that we were unprepared and that we had to bring departments together. And this was the first time we had threats that were being directed from overseas with supporters here in this country. And that was the reason. That was, again, you had 3,000 killed. There's no domestic terror attack I know that comes close to 3,000 people being killed. We had to worry about issues like chemical plant security. I'm not aware of domestic terror groups going after chemical plants. That took us to get legislation through, and that alone, in the year that I was, or the 15 months that I was chairman, that must have taken 6, 7, 8 months alone to get that done. Because not only do we have to fight off industry, we had to fight off the other committees in the Congress who were trying to restrict our jurisdiction. And that was implemented after a long, tough fight. The same with port security, the same with airline security, the same with rail and mass transit security. This was a new phenomenon in our country, and we were doing all we could to address it. We had to set up the system of grants to make sure that the funding was sent to the cities and states and local governments that needed that funding. For instance, in New York alone, we set up the Secure the Cities program over the objections of the Obama administration, and this was $26 million was put in to protect us against dirty bomb attacks. I'm not aware right now of domestic groups being trained overseas how to use nuclear dirty bombs against our cities. This is all the things we were doing at that time. We had plots, and we had to adapt to plots as they came along. There was an attempt to blow up John F. Kennedy Airport with the exploding the gasoline pipes below the airport. There was the Christmas Day bombing we saw. We saw the, if you're talking about a domestic attack, the attack that was stopped when Zazi, who was born overseas, educated in New York, went back to Afghanistan to be trained, came back here. He and three others were planning a liquid explosive attack that came within hours of succeeding in 2009. That would have made 9/11 look less than it was. That would have been hundreds, maybe thousands of people would have been killed. Then we had to observe what was happening overseas. We saw the bombings on the London subways. We had to then try to adapt here in this country how we would counter that. We saw the Mumbai attack, where we saw using fire as a weapon. These were all things we were doing. No one at that time was minimizing any attack by domestic terrorists. But we had to, I believe, answer the message that was sent to us by the Congress, by the President of both administrations of combating terrorism. We had Secretary Napolitano coming up to brief us, and Secretary Jay Johnson coming up. 99% of what they told us was about Islamist fundamentalist terrorism from overseas being directed here. Now, one of the reasons why, when people say in the last several years there's been more people killed by domestic terrorists rather than by international terrorists, one of the reasons for that is we've been successful. We have set up defenses. We do have them on the run. And it's under both administrations. I'm not trying to make this a partisan issue at all. We work together. And I think it does an injustice to this committee, and it does an injustice to what we're trying to do by somehow saying, because this committee didn't work on and did not have hearings exclusively on domestic terrorism that we didn't care about. That's like saying somebody who's in a burglary squad doesn't care about rape, or somebody in a homicide squad doesn't care about bank robberies. We had our lane, and we were told what we had to do. It was the Judiciary Committee, which had prime jurisdiction over the issue of domestic terrorism. They're the ones who had prime jurisdiction over the FBI. We actually have no real jurisdiction over the FBI. We had to fight hard enough to get what we have. So, Mr. Chairman, all I'm saying is, listen, I fully support these hearings. We're at a stage now where this is a new threat, an evolving threat, more sophisticated threat, and this is a very important hearing to have on domestic terrorism. But somehow to say that people didn't care about it before and didn't care about the loss of human life and didn't care about the victims of that and their families is wrong. It's an injustice committee, and I take strong exception to it, Mr. Chairman, especially when you were chairman and did nothing on it yourself.
Gentleman from New York finished?
I'm finished.
Well, let me just, for the record, indicate that the briefings that we started under my committee. I assure you that we'll continue to address any form of terrorism, international or domestic. The hearing today is to talk about domestic terrorism, how it look, what the departments are doing to combat it, and that's why our witnesses are presenting the testimony here today. So at this point, we'll go forward and we'll ask the questions, but the goal is to find out what domestic terrorism in the United States looks like today. Our witnesses are trying to share that with us, and this is just part of what our responsibility as a committee is to do. And as long as I'm chair, we'll do just that.
Mr. Chairman, would you yield on that?
We'll get back to you. We'll now recognize the gentlelady from Illinois, Ms. Underwood.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for holding this hearing today. One of the biggest challenges that we face as we confront domestic terrorism is the ease and speed with which the racist, misogynist, and other extremist ideologies that can fuel terrorism are spread online. In March, representatives from social media companies briefed members of this committee on online extremism. And while I appreciated their willingness to join the conversation, I was frankly really disappointed by how unprepared they were to provide sufficient answers in that briefing. Online extremism is not a new issue by any means, and yet many social media companies have been slow to respond to the serious threat that it poses to American lives. They may not have uniform community standards or adequate content reviewing processes or good information sharing with law enforcement. So my first questions are to the whole panel. How can social media companies like YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter improve their efforts to work with your agencies to counter domestic terrorism, and what are they doing right and what needs to get better? We can start with Mr. Murphy. Thank you.
Thank you for the question. The department over the last 2 years has engaged with social media companies to encourage the social media companies to continue to police their websites. I think we've seen some fruit of that by working with them. And I think those efforts are ongoing, and we welcome a continual dialogue with the social media companies to continue to improve upon that process.
So you think that the level of engagement is sufficient?
And so the department is engaging with the social media company. It is a coalition of the willing. We are making strides, and we would like to continue to make those strides.
Thank you. Mr. McGarrity.
Sure. So we obviously have very robust engagement with the social media companies, both as a training platform, where we will go out and we will give briefings on international terrorism and domestic terrorism, as we do with many of our private sector partners, banks, online companies, shippers, anything that there could be a tripwire that could help really to inform people for the see something, say something strategy. So we certainly do that, and we're very robust with that. Then when we do have an interest in something on social media or on the internet and, through a company, we obviously have judicial process that we will go through the U.S. Attorney's Office or through a national security letter on the international terrorism side to do a process, a legal process to request records and content, whether it's a search warrant or subpoena.
Thank you. And Mr. Wegman?
I guess the only thing I would add is just to note that when we're talking about extremist content online, the First Amendment does impose some significant constraints. We can't initiate, even if a social media company was to report to us, this terrorist has put a manifesto, or this person has put up a thing criticizing various ethnic groups or whatever online. That's not something that we can initiate an investigation solely on the basis of that information. So it's not as if just knowledge, in other words, the social media companies report to us extremist content online, doesn't necessarily give us the basis to initiate investigative activity.
And in your perspective, how would you compare social media companies' ability to respond to foreign terrorist threats to their ability to respond domestically? Would you say that they're equal, more or less?
I would see, I've been in this role 15 months. I will say when I got here, even on the international terrorism side, the self-regulation of their term of use agreements, they've gotten much better. I will say on the domestic terrorism side, I will see that there's likely going to be an increase on, well, there's a learning curve there as to what the social media companies have to do. I can tell you it appears, and this is open source, that they're hiring a lot of retired analyst agents,
sure,
detectives to do that. And so that's a good thing that they're doing that. But I can tell you just a few years ago, you did not see these social media companies self-identifying content. They are doing that now. And it will just take time, I think, with this evolving threat on both the homegrown violent extremist threat and the domestic terrorism threat here in the U.S., that they'll do the same on that.
Thank you. Facebook recently announced that it would begin redirecting users who search for white supremacist terms to an anti-extremism organization called Life After Hate, based in my home state of Illinois. Life After Hate is one of the only organizations in the country dedicated to helping people leave white supremacist ideologies. But the Trump administration canceled critical grant funding for the organization in 2017, and it's never replaced it. And Facebook alone has over 2 billion users, and Life After Hate is one of the relatively small organizations. And so with this cut in funding, this organization cannot be expected to neutralize every neo-Nazi on the internet. Did any of your agencies or departments engage with Life After Hate following Facebook's announcement to ensure they have the resources to make this partnership successful? Do you know?
I'm not aware that we did.
And the others?
Ma'am, we'll have to get back to you. I'm not sure.
Okay. We know that domestic terror incidents related to white supremacists are on the rise. We know that Congress is willing to fully resource DHS. I've only been here a few months, and I've already voted to increase funding for the agency. But resources are important, but so is directing them appropriately. DHS and other agencies need to ensure that these issues are being taken seriously and doing so in an open and transparent way. American lives depend on it. Mr. Chairman, I'm looking forward to working with you and other colleagues on this committee to make sure that happens. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Chair now recognizes gentleman from North Carolina, Mr. Walker.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm going to get away from my notes just for a second and speak freely. I understand what this hearing is about, and there was a time when our government, specifically even the DOJ, and as a pastor for 16 years, even the church looked the other way at some of the atrocities from some of these hate crimes and the terrorist activity that we saw in our communities. I was raised in the Deep South and saw it myself at times. However, I do want to acknowledge that this country has made great strides in stamping out this bigotry and these racist thugs and the damage that they would try and do. And I would hope that you know and fellow members that that we will stand arm in arm with you when we see this, whether there's a 17% increase or a 17% decrease. I do believe that we also have to make sure that we don't infringe on the free speech component as well, and that is a concern. So my first question for Mr. Wigman is, how does your agency define a hate crime when prosecuting one of these cases?
Thank you for that question. I actually have the definition of hate crime here in that Congress has provided in the federal code.
If it's less than 15, 20 seconds, I'd like to hear it.
Okay, I'll try to read it quickly. This is in section 249. Whoever willfully causes bodily injury, and I'm paraphrasing a little bit here, to any person through the use of fire or firearm, dangerous weapon, et cetera, to any person because of the actual or perceived race, color, religion, or national origin of any person. So
thank
causing
you.
Violence to people on the basis of race, color, religion, national origin is essentially what a hate crime is.
Based on the definition that you just gave, I want to give you an example from this week. Brian Sims, a Pennsylvania state representative, verbally attacked three teenage girls, threatening to dox them, which means to basically go after them on social media or on the internet, even offered $100 if somebody would give up their names to be able to embarrass them, to trash them. Would you say that would fall under a hate crime?
I'd have to all the facts. I'm just reluctant to comment on any particular
okay.
fact.
Well, just okay. So even the facts that I gave you just there, you don't want to comment on them today.
I'm just really reluctant, particularly if there is an investigation, which I don't know of that particular matter, to comment and get out front of what.
What understand? Okay. Well, then let me ask this: how does the Department of Justice draw the line between the right to assemble, protected by the U.S. Constitution, and the investigation or prosecution of a case as domestic terrorism?
So people have the right to assemble, petition, march in support of a particular cause, whether it's one that people generally find popular or not. That's something they can do. What they can't do is cross the line over into violence. And so the line that we draw and the FBI draws is you're free to assemble, you're free to petition your government.
So you can say pretty much anything. In the case of Mr. Sims, he said, "Bring it, Bible bullies, online." He tweeted this: "You are bigot, sexist, misogynist, and I see right through your fake morals and your broken values." So he's got clear lanes to be able to say anything he wants to in that aspect, is what you're saying.
You can say a lot of things that most people in this room would find repulsive and inappropriate, repugnant, but unless you're crossing that line over into either a threat, if it's a threat, that can be prosecuted. We have a number of threat statutes. or unless you're intending to incite violence,
sure.
As the Supreme Court has defined the line on that.
So basically, people are okay to say something stupid. Check our Facebook pages if you need any evidence of that. What I'd like to transition is for a couple questions for Mr. Murphy. How would you define the DHS's role in combating domestic terrorism?
Thank you for that question, sir. So we have several roles in the department. One of them is which to work with our state and local colleagues to make sure that they have all the information they need at that level. They're the closest ones to the fight against domestic terrorism, and we work every day to provide them that information.
Okay. Have you seen an increase, decrease, or about the same number of resources from your agency being devoted to domestic terrorism over the last decade?
So I'd say within the last 2 years, we've approximately doubled that number of people that are in my office that work on the domestic terrorism aspect of things.
And what is the process like that for your agency to be able to share that information?
So right now, one of the ways in which we do it, there's not just one way. We work with all our partners here at this table. But for the department, we look at what I described earlier, HIS and Intel, which is an intelligence sharing platform for law enforcement. We take the metrics we put on there very seriously. We continue to evaluate those numbers. And as I stated earlier, our number of products we're sharing is up by 64%. And the quality of the products is far increased. And one of the metrics we use is how often they get looked at and the returns that we see. So those numbers are soaring, quite frankly, around 325% increase and 90% approval rating of the products put out there.
Mr. Chairman, my time has expired. I yield back.
Thank you very much. Chair now recognizes the young lady from Michigan, Ms. Slotkin.
Hey, thank you for being here. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for having this hearing. Can you tell me, Mr. Murphy, on the intelligence side, we're seeing an increase in domestic terrorism. Can you explain to me why, based on your analysis?
So, ma'am, I think I would I'd answer the question this way. We look continually for threats of violence. We continue to readjust how those threats of violence manifest themselves in the homeland. Part of our efforts have looked at that agile nature of which homegrown violent extremists, regardless of ideology, pick up a reason to perform acts of violence against others and how quickly that manifests. So as we've been more targeted in the way we do it, we've seen our numbers in terms of those that could be acting on violence increase. We refer those leads over for investigation to state and local law enforcement and the FBI.
So just so I understand, then your answer is you're looking harder, so you're finding more cases. That's the reason we've had an increase in domestic terrorism cases?
So ma'am, as I think we said before, we've adjusted to a 24/7 cycle. Part of that it has been explained by myself and others here in terms of how the internet has been a major factor in all threats of violence and the ability of adversaries to talk to each other over the internet anonymously sometimes and avoid those face-to-face meetings. And as that has changed society writ large, we've adjusted to that.
So for both Mr. Murphy and Mr. McGarrity, so you're referencing the use of social media. So then we should see a straight line increasing in domestic terrorism from the advent of the internet to today. Do we see a straight line in an increase in domestic terrorism? Mr. McGarrity, why don't you take this one? Or has it been, I mean, I'm just trying to be honest here about the nature of the threat. I think you guys have done a phenomenal job on preventing another foreign terrorist attack. I think we have to give you guys a ton of credit for the fact that we haven't had another large-scale attack in the United States. But I want to be honest about the way the increase has happened. Has it been continuous since the advent of the internet? Or is there other factors? Has it been precipitous in the past few years?
I can't speak back to the internet, but I think that's a good question to look at. What I can speak to, if you look at points in time as far as our case numbers now, I gave a number of 850. And if you just look 6 months ago, we're actually down in cases, but cases are a point in time, right? We can literally open and close cases every day, so it's two data points, but certainly worth looking at. What I can tell you of what we're seeing is the velocity in which our subjects and the velocity in which we're working our cases, both on the domestic terrorism side and the international terrorism side with homegrown violent extremists, That velocity is much quicker than it's ever been before. Now, Mr. Murphy and I spoke before about the insular nature and the internet. When you can go on the internet and find content that justifies what you want to do, your specific ideology, whatever that ideology is, that and the ability not to have to travel to meet someone, not to have to go into a group setting. First, it makes it harder for us to detect you from a law enforcement perspective, because you're finding, but second, less conspiratorial, right? So you're less engaged with other people to conspire to commit attacks. You're finding the ideology, you're radicalizing fairly quickly, quicker than we've seen before, certainly years ago, even before 9/11 or after when we saw the foreign fighters. And on the domestic terrorism side, that mobilization of violence is much quicker. Mm-hmm.
So you said you had 850 cases that were open, and I understand they're just a spot check in the, you know, at a moment in time. How many of those cases are white supremacist cases?
So from our racially motivated violent extremism, the term we use, of the 850, approximately half are anti-government, anti-authority. Another 40% are racially motivated violent extremist cases, so 40% of the 850. Within that, a majority, but it's a significant majority, are racially motivated extremists who support the superiority of the white race.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you for that. And I've seen a report, but please correct me, that out of 2,000 counterterrorism analysts or specialists that you have, that you have 350 of those 2,000 are focused on domestic terrorism. Is that figure right, wrong? Please correct me if I have that wrong.
So again, I'm going to put it in a different way, but yeah. I think it answers your question. If you look at the way we are set up on our counterterrorism, our agents in the field and our agents at headquarters, our agents in the field, it's about an 80-20 split as far as the number of cases in international terrorism. So 80% of those cases we work are international terrorism cases, which includes homegrown violent extremists, which are about 1,000. And I gave you a number of 850. If you look, the agents in the field marry up about 80%, 20% as to our case ratios and then the agents working. So we have about 20% of our counterterrorism agents working domestic terrorism in the field and about 80% international terrorism. But that marries up almost exactly to the number of cases we have in the field as international terrorism and domestic terrorism. Back at headquarters, we have an entire section for domestic terrorism operations section, just like we do an international terrorism operations section in the homeland. They're both sections, equal sections. We have an analyst, and then we use our human section, everything else to augment that. But we are set up, we are mirrored right now in our domestic terrorism operations section to do the same work we do as our international terrorism operations section, absent the laws that we're allowed to do different things for international terrorism, but the way we're structured within the counterterrorism division is the same.
Okay, and I think my time has expired, is that correct? Sorry, the clock is, I'm happy to go by the clock if you want me to go by the clock, but I think it's expired, so thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Louisiana, Mr. Higgins.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to commend the chairman and the ranking member for the tone I'm witnessing of this hearing. It's an important hearing, and I'm finding the questions very fair and bipartisan and focused on the issue at hand, and that certainly comes from the example set by leadership here. So I thank you, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Ranking Member. Gentlemen, thank you for your service to your country and your testimony today. Mr. McGarrity, our research shows that the FBI currently has approximately 900 domestic terrorism investigations ongoing. Is that correct? Round number.
It can hover 850 right now. It could be 850.
And just for perspective for the American people and for this committee, how does that number compare to investigations passed, let's say, a decade ago?
That I can't speak to, but we certainly can get that number and get it back to you.
Would you agree that the investigations into domestic terror has grown, though, at the FBI over the course of the last decade?
And see, what
investigations into domestic terror?
We've always been set up to work domestic terrorism. We've always, obviously, the history will show, we've worked it.
You believe there's a heightened awareness within the investigative community of the FBI?
I would say it's a very heightened
awareness. Okay, that's a fair statement. Would you agree? Of course, all of us here need to ensure that these investigations are conducted thoroughly. It's critical for the safety of all Americans. I'm concerned regarding some exit from the Joint Terrorism Task Forces nationwide. In my opinion, that's the front line of this mission to combat domestic terror. Working with and sharing critical information with local law enforcement agencies as they conduct criminal investigations, which can lead ultimately to the reveal of domestic terror intent. And recently, certain jurisdictions have withdrawn from the Joint Terrorism Task Forces. Mr. McGarrity, to what extent, in your opinion, does withdrawal from Joint Terrorism Task Force, how would that impact our ability as a nation, considering the relationship between local law enforcement, where these investigations commonly begin, and federal law enforcement? What's your opinion on how important the Joint Terrorism Task Forces are, sir?
I would say that our Joint Terrorism Task Force, as stated before, is really the recipe for our success and what we've done over the last year since 9/11. Nothing the FBI does in the counterterrorism world we do alone. We do with partners. In those cases, I spoke about the referrals that we get. 50% of our referrals for our cases come in not only from state local partners, so whether on the JTTF or not, but from the public. And there's no one better than a state and local law enforcement officer that knows the public. So that information intake into the Joint Terrorism Task Force is crucial. Having membership there, nothing beats two people sitting side by side working a case together for a disruption as far as how we'll be successful in that case.
I concur with that assessment, and thank you for clarifying for us all. In my home state of Louisiana, actually, in my neighborhood, recently, three Christian, predominantly African-American churches were burned to the ground, and that investigation was conducted with incredible professionalism by Louisiana State Fire Marshal and his team, working with local law enforcement and ultimately federal law enforcement. Fire Marshal Butch Browning did an amazing job leading the investigation. This initially began as an arson investigation. Then when the second church burned, of course, the team was on the ground. And the sharing of data at the local, state, and federal level was just an uplifting thing to behold. And ultimately, the arrest was made, and the suspect was found to be involved in following pagan religion rituals of burning old steeples, and which found in rural areas. So my question to you again, Mr. McGarrity, are there additional investigative or prosecutorial authorities needed to better address, is there a piece of this puzzle that we're missing that this body can help you fill?
As far as any certain legislation from this body, certainly defer to the Department of Justice, and I know they're committed to working through possibilities. From my perspective, whether I'm working gangs, MS-13, or terrorism, any tool in the toolbox helps me when I'm looking at that threat every day as to what my options are and how I can disrupt that threat before an attack.
Thank you, gentlemen, for your service and your testimony today. Mr. Chairman, I yield.
Thank you. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Missouri, Ms. Cleaver.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. A. Holland, my teacher, she taught us, you know, O.B. some other name. What's in a name? That which we call a rose by any other name smells as sweet. We learned that out of Romeo and Juliet because we were studying semantics. And that's where I'd like for this conversation to go, if you will. In the FBI, in your report, there's a category of domestic terrorism called racially motivated violent extremism. And then in the 2017 FBI Counterterrorism Division, a report was distributed called Black Identity Extremist, Likely Motivated to Target Law Enforcement Officers. Semantics. I don't understand. First of all, can you tell me what Black Identity Extremist is, Mr. McGarty?
So it's a term that we don't use, I haven't used in how we look at the threat since I've been here for the past 15 months. What it was is it's a term that came out from an effort to better define the threat that we saw specifically 2015, but specifically in July 2016, the July 7th two attacks against law enforcement, and then the July 17th attack as well, and then the follow-on attacks. So you had attacks in Tennessee, Baton Rouge, as well as Dallas, and then a follow-on attack in the fall. And it was a perspective, something where they saw a change, and the analysts attempt to highlight that change and analyze it. I can tell you, since I'm here, and I think your next part is that, why are we calling it racially motivated violent extremism? Because that's what we're focused on, is the violence. You know, everything's First Amendment protected right. You could be a white supremacist. I'm not going to investigate you because you have an ideology. I'm going to investigate you because you have an ideology that you're pursuing violence to attack others. That's where I'm going to investigate.
Okay. I can appreciate that because I think I got a little 3-year-old grandson, and I'm wanting desperately for him to grow up in a nation where we are not bitterly divided by, partisan politics and race and so forth. And so, I appreciate your response, and that you don't use that term, but it's out in the world, and I'm hoping that we can, if we're going to use race, and instead, for example, we don't say white supremacist extremism, we say racially motivated. And so, do you think it would be more helpful if we're just going to put everything in one category, and that is, racially motivated violent extremism? I mean, in other words, here we say racially motivated violent extremism, and so we leave out white supremacy, but then in 2017 we have black. Identity supremacist. Identity extremist. I don't understand why we're separating it.
So right now, I can tell you the way we're set up, the way we look at it, racially motivated violent extremism, and that's a term that when we were doing.
No. You said racially motivated violent extremism. I'm talking about the 2017. It says black identity.
That was a report that was done, as I said, based upon the acts in 2016 to analyze a set of circumstances and events. I can tell you we don't use that term since I've been here.
Okay.
And we use the term racially motivated violent extremism.
Which would include everything.
Well, it includes everything, but it allows us also to track if there is a ideology where someone is looking to push forward the supremacy of the white race, or if someone has a perceived injustice because of something, to use violence. So if we need to track numbers, we can do that, because we do need to understand the threat. Mm-hmm. But what I need to do is I need to train my task force officers, my analysts, my agents, that it's the violence we're focused on. And it's the violence, it's not the ideology. The ideology will likely get you to the violence and the hate, but we need to focus on the violence, and that's why we use the term we use now. And we've been using it for 15 months. I've had a conversation with members of Noble on the Black Law Enforcement Executive Committee. We've reached out, obviously, to the Black Congressional Caucus, offering to speak to them. And we've also had one of our senior executives in charge of domestic terrorism speak at the Noble Conference.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. Chair, I recognize the gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Joyce.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Ranking Member Rogers. I'd like to thank the witnesses for being here today to continue this ongoing dialogue. Recently, members of this committee had the opportunity to hear representatives from social media. Their concerns were our concerns as well. Regarding this, what level of cooperation do you receive from the major social media companies when they identify threats or acts of violence that are on their platforms that are being actively discussed? Do they proactively share this information with you? And what steps do you then take? Mr. McGarrity, I'll ask you to address first, please.
I can't speak to every company, but certainly many of the major companies do give us leads, tips, when they see something. Now, when we get that information, that doesn't mean we can do something if it's strictly First Amendment activity. But through we can run checks, we might be able to take an assessment and predicate a full investigation or a preliminary investigation. I can't say they all do that. Now, there's certainly companies out there that don't, but we are seeing a tide change in social media companies being more proactive, policing their own, and when they see something, partly because they have retired law enforcement analysts in there, when they see something that is noteworthy and alarming beyond First Amendment, they will give us leads.
Can you quantitate that, Mr. McGarrity? Can you see trends that you can share with us?
As to leads coming in?
Yes, sir.
We can look, we haven't looked at that, whether it's, I can tell you from where I sit on the threats we're working at, we do get leads coming in from some of the major social media companies. I haven't looked at the statistical analysis or trends, but it's certainly more than I'm sure we got in years past.
Is that something that would be easily quantitated? Is that something that you have the resources to do?
Certainly something we could do. It's resources are obviously you're taking people off to do different things, but it's certainly something we can look at to see if it's possible, to see if it's something that's worth tracking.
Are there additional measures that you think the social media platforms should be dialoguing with you regarding that?
We are certainly training them on what the threats are when we talk about the international terrorism and domestic terrorism threats as far as what they do on their own use agreements. And with their lawyers, that's what they do internally. We certainly educate people to the threat, whether they're a social media company or a bank or a shipping company.
You talked earlier about the radicalization and how easily that is to be obtained, that information on the internet. Do you think they are taking the appropriate response from the social media platforms in addressing this with the education that you provide them?
I can't speak to, there's a lot of hate out there on the internet. I can't speak to exactly how much of their efforts that they are doing. I can tell you on open source, different companies have been more forthcoming in what they're producing as far as self-identifying content that's unacceptable. But I can't tell you exactly what they're doing inside the companies.
Mr. Murphy and Mr. Wigman, would you be interested in commenting to this as well?
I would say that the department in the last 2 years has looked at working with the major social media companies and through a coalition of the willing and others, which is largely known as the global internet forum to counter terrorism. We do see that those efforts are bearing some fruit. I think we have a long way to go with it, and we look forward to continuing to engage with the social media companies in that environment.
Mr. Wigman.
I don't have anything further to add.
Thank you. Thank you for your comments. Mr. Chairman, I yield.
Thank you. Chair now recognizes the young lady from New York, Ms. Clark.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman. I thank our ranking member, Mr. Rogers, and I thank our panelists for bringing their expertise to the panel today. Mr. Wegman, you mentioned something that has not set well with me, and I wanted to give you an opportunity to explain, because I understand the delicate balance between First Amendment rights and operationalizing things, but if it was brought to your knowledge that there was a manifesto online, is there a process that you have to sort of vet that? You made it sound as though, oh, anyone can print a manifesto and this is like a common practice. But we're finding that these manifestos are sort of a precursor to operationalizing events. So can you give me a sense of exactly what you were saying?
Yeah. So I totally get your concern, because these online statements, as Mr. McGarrity has explained, are exactly the kind of things that can lead people to radicalize and turn to violence. The challenge really lies in, and I'll just talk briefly about the First Amendment jurisprudence here. There's a famous Supreme Court case.
No, I don't want to go that far. I don't want you to go that deep.
Okay.
I'm saying you mentioned that if you saw a manifesto online, it is commonly viewed as freedom of speech. Yeah. And what I'm saying is that what we have found, the trend has been that as these manifestos appear, we usually find out after the fact that someone operationalized the use of a manifesto, right? So what I'm asking is, have there been new protocols put in place? Because I don't want it to be said out there that, oh, manifestos can pop up online. We have nothing in terms of vetting, or there's no process. Mm-hmm. When it's brought to our knowledge.
Yeah, my point is just that we're gonna need more than just a statement, depending on what the statement says. If it's a statement that indicates threats of violence, we can investigate that. If we have additional information about the individual, he has this manifesto, but we know the person's out buying a gun, or we have a source inside that says this person we think is turning violent.
So there is a process.
So there is a process that the FBI is doing in any individual case to evaluate, do we have that enough evidence to predicate an investigation and open it? And we are pushing up against that line, in other words, in every case, to say, okay, do we have enough? Do
it's
we
not, not
have
as enough? Though the FBI hasn't done it before, so.
That's right. So they're going to be looking in those cases to see whether they have enough information and material to consistent with the policy of not investigating.
Why don't I switch over to Mr. McGarrity, because we don't have a whole lot of time, and sort of get your take on
I think
that.
If you look at some of the manifestos that we've seen more recently last year, a lot of those manifestos will actually have intent to violence in there as well. So when we get that, that's a clue, that's a lead that we can look at and start. It's still going to come in under a guardian to look at. There's very few things we can do, but as we build upon that and certain predications are met, we can then likely take it into.
Because I want to just sort of do a comparison between when you find that type of, or you're giving that type of intelligence from an international perspective. Your job then is to mobilize, to disrupt any act of violence that that you believe can be operationalized from that type of chatter, that type of material. Is that the same type of sort of intelligence that you use when one comes across these types of materials?
So if I'm looking at a threat, whether it's IT, international terrorism, or domestic, I'm looking at that threat the same way to stop it, right? But the difference on the international terrorism side is the foreign terrorism organizations, those that are designated foreign terrorist organizations, whether it's Al-Qaeda or ISIS. That does give us more latitude, because you're actually saying, I'm going to do something for ISIS, or I'm with ISIS. That does give us more latitude to look
at. How does it give you more latitude?
They're actually designated as a terrorist organization.
So we don't designate white supremacist organizations as terrorist organizations?
So a white supremacist organization is an ideology. It's a belief.
They're not. But it's designated as a terrorist organization.
We don't have designated terrorist organizations on the
that are domestic.
Correct.
That's good to know. Mr. McGarrity, I'm concerned about the FBI not being having dedicated sufficient personnel and resources to combating domestic terrorism, along with the fact that we don't even label our organizations as domestic terrorists. What is the breakdown of FBI agents, analysts, headquarters, and analysts in the field dedicated to white supremacist militia threats or other forms of domestic terrorism versus forms of Islamic extremism?
Good question. I alluded to it before. We are set up. We've actually looked at that. Those agents in the field that work domestic terrorism are about 20%. And we have about 80% working international terrorism. But if you look at our case numbers, right, so if you look at those things that come in that we can predicate into an investigation, they line up about 20% domestic terrorism, 80% international terrorism. We have domestic terrorism squads in major field offices. We at least have one counterterrorism squad in every field office, 56. We have single domestic terrorism squads in the larger ones. But if you're working in a rural area, you say you're in an area with five agents in that area, covering that area, and that threat comes in, whether it's domestic terrorism, international terrorism, public corruption, or white collar, and that's a threat, that is taking the priority. So as much as we're set up that way with cases, we're certainly set up to deal with the threats as they come in. And at headquarters, We've done a realignment within the counterterrorism division. We've always had a domestic terrorism operations section for the last couple of years, but we are lined up as how we work at our human, our source, our collection, our analysis, and our ops is mirrors up between domestic terrorism operations section and our international terrorism operations section. The only difference is we also have another section that's overseas for those cases, investigations that take us extraterritorial.
Very well. You're back, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you. Chair now recognizes the gentleman from New York, Mr. Katko.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for convening this hearing. It's very important that we give the domestic terrorism its due as a problem in this country that's escalating, and I'll get to more of that in a moment. I want to pause for a few seconds to thank someone from my office, Tim Wang, who is today's his last day, and since he's been with me, he spent every day working to help keep our country safe and keeping me ready for these hearings. So thank you, Tim, and good luck. Mr. McGarrity, I want to talk to you briefly about, you said about 80% versus 20% international domestic split as far as resources and these investigations. Is that true for the JTTFs as well?
Yeah, so the JTTFs are the components that work these cases in the field, so it would marry up. What it doesn't count is our task force officers assigned to both domestic terrorism and international. And I don't know the numbers on that, but I would assume that would line up pretty much the same as well. Okay. That's our field component.
Very fine. Thank you very much. And Mr. Murphy, I want to talk to you a little bit more about the social media component. To me, one of the biggest problems we've had with domestic terrorism and the spread of international terrorism in the United States is the ability of the internet to unlock the latent tendencies of somewhat dormant people that are angry. They can scratch your itch by going to a certain site or talking to a certain person, and next thing you know, you go from someone with some feelings to someone with actions, and it's very, very hard to detect. I think social media companies need to be held accountable more and be more active. I know from what I've seen with cybersecurity issues, my chair, ranking member in cybersecurity, different performances based on companies. Some companies are much more diligent about it, and some people care a lot less about it. So is there anything we should or could be doing in Congress to hold those social media companies' feet to the fire more about being better stewards of what's being posted and how it's being posted?
Sir, thank you for the question. So the department continues to work with the social media companies I had brought up before. The larger social media companies seem to be more engaged. I can't explain the exact reasons for that. I know we will
self-preservation property, but probably, but that's okay. I mean, that's whatever the motivation is, it's good that they're engaged. Some just aren't, though, you know?
We will look to continue to expand those relationships to include all social media companies if possible, and working with our partners here to educate those social media companies about the threats. And then what they do with that information, as my colleague said, it does vary from social media company to social media company.
Okay, thank you. And I want to switch gears one more time, and that is with, if you see something, say something campaigns throughout the country. An outgrowth of that is something I've pushed very hard for is red flag bills. That my bill has due process considerations in it to keep firearms out of the hands of people that are about to go into a school into a shooting, and try and find those needles in the haystacks, listen to the concerns, listen to the warnings, and then try and act upon them before they actually happen. Is a red flag concept something that might be advisable in the domestic terrorism realm?
Red flag as to training people to understand what the indicators are?
Right, but also intervening with these people before they act. If they're exhibiting sufficient signs of about ready to commit acts of violence, or that they have mental health issues, and they're talking about this and engaging in this extreme language, they're exhibiting signs that they might be ready to pop off. Is there something we can do to intervene with them and perhaps get the firearms out of their hands before they actually act?
So certainly that's a possibility. What we want to do is we want to train people to see what those indicators are. So like NCTC, the FBI, and DHS put out the indicators to mobilization of violence. It's a couple years old, but it's specific to the homegrown violent extremist threat, which mirrors the domestic terrorism threat as to these lone offenders, once they have access to a firearm, can do an attack. So what we want our schools, our teachers, our communities to know that. the bystander effect that we talk about many times, when you look back, and we've studied this on the homegrown violent extremist side and the attacker side, you look back, there's at least one person who sees that radicalization change, who sees that mobilization, likely one indicator or grievance that does.
Like it. San Bernardino, for
yes,
example.
Yes, we want to get that. So this is, I mean, this is what's out there. We throw that out to state locals as well as schools. But that's what we want to do, is get them to know what those indicators are and what behavior changes could be there. If someone, I'm all for, if someone can get to someone before I see them and stop something, that's great.
Or get the information to you so you can.
Absolutely. Yeah. And that, I will tell you, if you look at our tips that come in, obviously 50% come from state, local, or public tips. So when I look at a state or local tip through the Joint Terrorism Task Force, many of those secondarily, collaterally, are from the local community. We've seen an increase in community tips coming in. That's a good news story from years of see something, say something, but it's also getting it out that there's likely one person who saw this or saw the change.
Thank you very much. I yield back, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you. The chair now recognizes the gentlelady from New York, Ms. Rice.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Mr. Ranking Member. And I would just like to start by saying that I would ask every one of my colleagues on this committee to take the bold step, and I hope our other colleagues from both sides of the aisle will join us, in being willing to be courageous enough to condemn any kind of incendiary rhetoric coming from either side of the aisle. That's what the public expects, and yet what we do time and time again is R's pick on D's and D's pick on R's. Uh-huh. And they make a distinction where there is no difference. And I think that in the positions that we are in, we owe it to the public to be courageous enough to stand up and say, yes, you are from my party, but what you said is wrong. And I hope that we can do that and set the tone, because if we're doing that, I think the influence we will have over the general public will be much more positive in nature. On April, and this question is to everyone on the panel, on April 16th, a militia group called United Constitutional Patriots was videotaped on the southern border holding migrants in their custody at gunpoint. These men were shown wearing military-style uniforms, surrounding migrants with rifles and issuing commands to stop or sit. Needless to say, this is extremely disturbing. Private citizens acting in the role of law enforcement. Shortly afterward, the leader of the group was arrested by the FBI for illegal firearms possession. We know that unauthorized militias pose a problem to law enforcement across the country, and the militia movement has resurged in the past decade. Recently, in separate incidents in Nevada in 2014 and Oregon in 2015-2016, Clive and Bundy and his sons, I guess that's how you say his first name, and his sons, Eamon and Ryan, engaged in large armed standoffs with federal law enforcement officials. In 2016, three white men, members of a militia called the Crusaders, were arrested for a plot to bomb an apartment complex in Garden City, Kansas, that was home to many Somali immigrants. To the extent possible in a public setting, could all three of you summarize the current domestic terrorist threat posed by militias across the country and on the southern border specifically? What are your respective agencies doing to confront the threat posed by unauthorized armed militias? And I'll just stop there and ask all three of you to opine if you have anything to say.
Sure. Thank you, Representative. So certainly militia extremism, the focus on paramilitary training and acquisition of weapons, food supplies, and preparation for criminal confrontations with the government is concerning. Again, though, we have the First Amendment, so if it's a militia that's training, but there's no direction towards violence, we are prohibited from looking at that. Where we do see them move into the violence, and you've seen those in those arrests, we will go out and investigate those that are using militias to pursue violent ends to meet their ideology or, of course, the government to do something. So we've seen that. We've actually seen a decrease in militia extremism in the last couple years, partly because we think of some of the prosecutions, notable prosecutions, that we have done. So it's a slight decrease in the last couple years.
Ma'am, we actively look out at those groups out there that are threatening both citizens as well as members of the department. So you referenced the southern border. We as a department, receive threats from a variety of people that have certain passionate feelings about the Department of Homeland Security. Mm. We take all of that. We will immediately provide state and local law enforcement, as well as the Joint Terrorism Task Force, which the department has a number of folks on that supporting the FBI's efforts. And any investigation, then I would yield back, as Mr. McGarry has already talked about.
And then just to add, from our perspective, we are prepared, working with the FBI, to prosecute those cases. And the number of the ones you mentioned in your statement are ones that the Department of Justice has pursued successfully and prosecuted in the militia context. And there have been other older cases. And so we work closely with the FBI in terms of pursuing charges against those cases.
Thank you. Since 2014, at least four mass murders leading to 45 deaths have been committed by men who have identified or sympathized with the incel movement, which is, I'm sure you're all aware, an online subculture of misogynists who blame women for their involuntary celibacy. There is often overlap between this group of misogynist extremists and other violent hate groups of John Ernest, the self-identified white supremacist and anti-Semite who has been charged with last month's horrific shooting in a Southern California synagogue, also referenced misogynist beliefs in his manifesto on the website 8chan. You've spoken at length today about working with these platforms in terms of identifying this kind of speech, but it seems to me that there have been a number of incidents where these killers have given us a roadmap very clearly. I mean, these are not even on the dark web. It's on Facebook. It's on, you know, these platforms that are well known to everyone and reach enormous numbers of people. And I just think that we have to figure out a way to hold them accountable and work more closely with them, because we're getting the big red flag waving and we're not able to act on that information in a timely fashion. So I'm encouraged about the work that you're doing with a lot of these, you know, social media platforms, but obviously we have to continue to do more. Thank you all very much, and I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, and I'd like to just comment that the ranking member and of the subcommittee and the ranking member of the full committee, along with a number of us, are concerned about the very same thing. And we've tried to engage the social media companies to talk to us on what they're doing, best practices, other things, but some have, some haven't. But there are some challenges that we'll have to overcome, and we look forward to.
Mr. Chairman, just briefly, if I may, yeah. I would strongly encourage a committee to have another hearing on this and dig deeper into this area, because I think they need to get a kick in the butt to understand how serious this is.
Yeah, I can assure you it's on the way. Chair, now I recognize the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Crenshaw.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for holding this hearing. Thank you all for being here. This is a very important subject. I'll jump right into some questions. In the after I was injured, I worked primarily in the intelligence community, and we have ways of classifying different types of attacks, most deadly and most likely courses of action. Could Mr. McGarrity and Mr. Murphy briefly comment on what you believe to be the most deadly courses of action or possible domestic terror attacks, as well as the most likely?
I would say most deadly and most likely are both the lone offender who self-radicalized online, who has access to a weapon.
Concur fully with Mr. McGarrity's statements.
Okay, so and that is the trend we're seeing then. I mean, this is the concern. This is why we're having this hearing. There's this tendency to self-radicalize where we can't connect them with a broader network. We can't trace that back the way we used to do in the past. A question I have as well is, as we've effectively, not quite totally, but effectively and geographically defeated the caliphate and the ISIS caliphate in Syria, prior to this, we were seeing quite a few of these self-radicalized attacks because of their ability to radicalize people internally. Have we seen a downward trend in that specifically from ISIS in recent past because of military efforts abroad, or has it remained the same? Can we track those things?
I would say we have not, certainly not seen a decrease. I mean, and that's the problem set we have. As the ISIS caliphate shrinks, it's online. And so what you saw from AQAP with Inspire magazine and ISIS with the social media platforms that they pushed out, you can recycle that. So if you're sitting in a basement anywhere in the U.S., you can get online and see that. And that's what's alarming. So, and we did see that. I mean, just the arrest we just did a week ago in L.A., that was a self-radicalized, but certainly on the internet. That was alarming. So from our vantage point, the homegrown violent extremist threat is certainly a priority threat for us because they're still being radicalized. It almost doesn't matter whether the caliphate's physically there or not. Well,
the content has to come from somewhere, though. Are you able to track where that content is coming from?
Content is coming from all over the world at this point, right? Okay. As the caliphate shrunk and those safe havens are no longer existing, like we saw with AQAP in Yemen, you could be anywhere in the world right now and put this together, certainly with anonymizers, the Tor, and other things, you can push that out. So geographically, it's dispersed.
You have anything to add to that before I go on to the next one?
No, sir. Thank you.
I want to talk about collection efforts. You mentioned there's more open source and more targeted collection efforts coming out of DHS and a movement away from the analysis side of things. I want to ask real fast about how recruitment is going and personnel recruitment for these jobs. Do we need to increase recruitment? How is morale among these folks?
So speaking for DHS, I mean, we have dozens and dozens of people putting in for every job, up and down our kind of tree and for the various jobs. So we're fortunate to get a large pool of talent. So okay. we have no problem with in terms of numbers of people applying for jobs.
Okay, what about enough billets? I mean, trying to do open source analysis for such an enormous problem, which is trying to, you're trying to analyze the entire internet on who might be self-radicalized, do you need more?
Sir, we're always willing to, of course, get more resources and happy to work with you and Congress to get you a more concise explanation of that.
Yeah.
But we could, there's always more, as you described, that can be done on the internet. I mean, it is an endless.
On JTTFs in particular, so in my past, I worked a lot in the interagency. And in my experience, the interagency really only works because of personal relationships. The problem I always saw was that there's not an institutionalized reason to cooperate. There's not an institutionalized requirement to share information. Has that improved at all? Are there ways to improve that?
I would say from the operational side of the Joint Terrorism Task Force, I served on the one in New York City, and I've been stationed to the CIA as a detailee. I would say right now, within the USIC and our state and local partners, the partnerships are the best we've ever seen.
So as a member of DHS now, the previous 20 years I was in the FBI and led and was a part of multiple JTTFs. I would agree with that. I know from the departmental perspective now, through the FBI's leaderships on these task force, it continues to just be, for the most part, few people I'm sure out there really well led, and it's a good process.
All right. Thank you. I'm out of time. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Chair. Now I recognize the gentleman from Rhode Island, Mr. Langevin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank our witnesses for being here today and your testimony. If I could, for Mr. Wagaman and Ms. McGarrity, based on the testimony that you all given today, it's clear that the Justice, FBI, and DHS all consider domestic terrorism a threat. And so therefore, I want to talk about prioritization. Mr. Wagaman, you state that only two of the more than 40 National Security Division attorneys assigned to counter terrorism focus on domestic terrorism. So is this reflective of the threat?
No, just to be clear, all 40-plus attorneys in our counterterrorism section are available to work on both domestic and international terrorism matters. We don't have kind of dedicated, like, split up between domestic terrorism prosecutors and international terrorism prosecutors. We do have a domestic terrorism council who focuses exclusively kind of on our national program and two attorneys who support him and work on that work, but they're also available to do international terrorism matters as well. So the way we do it at Department of Justice is all of our attorneys who are specialized in counterterrorism can work either international or domestic terrorism cases. So all 40-plus attorneys are available for both, and what they work on depends on what threats are coming in the door and what cases are coming in. So
So in terms of cases that you charge 20 times as many foreign terrorist cases as domestic terrorism-related cases?
I couldn't give you an exact number on that in terms of how many we charge. You have to remember also that a lot of domestic terrorism cases are charged at the state level as well, more so than probably on the IT side, so you have to take those into account. And on the domestic terrorism side, some of them are charged as hate crimes under the Civil Rights Division, could even be a tax offense. They have tax protesters that are anti-government, so in comparing the numbers, you really would have to look across a broader spectrum.
Mr. McGarrity, November 2018 New York Times Magazine article reports that that the FBI counterterrorism agents candidly admitted that domestic terrorism is seen as a backwater, and that the only path to advancement was through international terrorism cases. Is that true? And how do you and the FBI leadership balance international terrorism and domestic terrorism?
Well, first, let me go back to as far as the prioritization. From the FBI perspective, counterterrorism, preventing a terrorism attack in the U.S. was, still, and will be, for as far as I can see, the number one priority of the FBI. So that's still our number one priority. We don't differentiate between a domestic terrorism attack we're trying to stop or an international terrorism attack. It's a terrorism attack we're looking to stop. So as far as our priorities, it's our number one priority in the FBI. As far as domestic terrorism being sleepy, I don't know who the source of that article was. I can tell you the passion in the way we run our day from early in the morning to late at night through phone calls at night. No one asks whether it's domestic terrorism or international terrorism. When the threat comes in, we work the threat. I would also argue that if you look at our leaders, a good example, former deputy director of the FBI, Mark Giuliano, actually came in and was the domestic terrorism operations section chief. He was in charge of domestic terrorism operations, moved into my position as the assistant director of counterterrorism, moved into the executive assistant director of the National Security Branch until he became the deputy director of the FBI. So I would argue, whoever made that comment, maybe that was the case years ago. I can tell you it's certainly not the case now in this FBI right now, and certainly not in the case in the counterterrorism division.
Okay. Thank you for clarifying. Mr. McGarrity, in your testimony, you referenced the fact that firearms remain a weapon of choice for domestic terrorists. Like many of my colleagues here, I believe that we need to do more for gun violence prevention. However, I'm also worried about the emerging avenues of attack, such as through the use of cyber tools. Does the FBI currently evaluate domestic terrorist cyber threat actors through its responsibilities under PPD-14? And how are terrorist capabilities to conduct disruptive or destructive cyber incidents evolving?
So within the FBI, we certainly have a counterterrorism division and a cyber division. I will tell you, though, most criminal violations the FBI work have some form of cyber to it, right? I mean, that's just the way we are working now. As far as a threat, I have not seen domestic terrorism using cyber per se to do an attack, but certainly if we saw it, we'd be working it like any other threat, and we'd certainly be leveraging the expertise of our cyber division.
Okay. Very good. See, my time's expired. Thank you for your testimony, and Mr. Chairman, thanks for holding this hearing. I yield back.
Thank you, Chair. Now I recognize the gentleman from Texas, Mr. McCall.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank the witnesses. I am chairing this committee for 6 years. We saw this come up multiple times. One time in my hometown of Austin, Texas, the Austin bomber. And when asked, is this an act of terrorism, it's of course it is. And it was random, and I want to commend the FBI for the great work y'all did in bringing that chapter to a close and saving lives. It was a great joint effort on the JTTF and with Austin Police. But as that unfolded, we looked at the issue of domestic terrorism. And I know as a former federal prosecutor, there's a definition, and cases can be opened as domestic terrorism cases, but there's no charge of domestic terrorism. There's international terrorism, And we see that many times in the cases we prosecuted against ISIS and Al-Qaeda and other extremist groups, but there is no charge for domestic terrorism. I think that's kind of getting to the heart of this hearing. And I was just curious what your thoughts would be on Congress enacting a domestic terrorism charge. What would be the benefits or risks of doing that? If I could just go down the panel.
Yeah, I can take that. So we're always looking to improve our authorities. And so I think we're certainly open to having a discussion with the Congress. If there's interest in the Congress in pursuing a domestic terrorism statute, we're certainly open to having that discussion. I think you'd have to think about exactly what issue you're trying to fix. As I've talked about in my opening testimony, we do have a number of statutes that we use in these domestic terrorism cases. So the question is, what gap would it fill exactly? We probably would not want, the one thing I would say, something that's similar to what we have on the international side, which is designating foreign terrorist organizations. We're not going to want to, for good policy reasons that I think the committee on both sides of the aisle would share, right, designating domestic groups as domestic terrorist organizations and picking out particular groups that you say you disagree with their views and so forth is going to be highly problematic in a way that's not when you're designating Al-Qaeda or ISIS or an international terrorist organization. So there's not going to be a precise analog on the domestic side, but that's not to say that there aren't other ways we could do, maybe analogizing to our current hate crime statutes, that would be something that we could do that would be broader on domestic terrorism.
Under a hate crime.
Kind of like hate crimes, except focused on domestic terrorism and the definition that we have in the code. So it's certainly a discussion that we're open to having with the Congress if there's interest.
I tend to agree. I think that's a better approach than labeling domestic terror organizations within the United States. It gets sort of problematic. Can you tell me how many domestic terrorism charges we have brought, last year, for instance?
So I don't have an exact figure on that. I would imagine it's somewhere between 0 and 100, but I don't know I don't have an exact number.
Okay. And how many international terrorism cases do we bring last year?
I just don't have that handy with me either today. So unfortunately, we could try to get you that number.
Okay. I think this is the issue the chairman and I have talked a lot about. We'd like to get to a place that, bipartisan to resolve some of this, because I think when you look at cases like the Austin bomber, it's hard for me to say that wasn't an act of terrorism. It certainly was. And so how do you go beyond just the definition, of domestic terrorism? And perhaps it's under a hate crime type law. Now, of course, in that case, I think he would have been charged with capital murder under Texas law, and that's the ultimate punishment. Hate crime doesn't have that sort of penalty provision to it.
No, it does. If death results, the death penalty is available.
So under the hate crime?
It can be, yes.
Okay.
I think Dylann Roof, for example.
Then perhaps, Mr. Chairman, that could be a way to look at this, perhaps under the hate crimes statute. I think that's a good answer. I'll yield back.
Thank you very much. Chair now recognizes the gentleman from Staten Island, New York, Mr. Rose.
Mr. Chairman, thank you so much for the opportunity. Mr. Murphy, you mentioned earlier the Global Internet Forum to Counter Terrorism, GIFCT, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
So the social media companies recently came before us and they humble bragged about this forum, that they had established it. So my first question is to each of you, were you aware of this forum, and have you had any direct communication with this forum, and if so, how often? And that is both you as well as your office. Let's start with Mr. Murphy.
Sir, thank you for the question. Under the office that I manage, I don't have direct engagement with that forum. Rather, our intelligence professionals provide background information and other things to the rest of the department that does engage. So we kind of serve as that node by which we help our officials that are going to be there understand what the issues are and be best informed to talk about.
Okay.
From the FBI perspective, we're absolutely involved in that process.
But Ms. McGarry, were you aware of this actual organization?
Yes, my question. Sir. In fact, part of that is the ACIPA process. There was a recent meeting just here in California. I was present there with members of DHS, Secretary Nielsen, and others.
Great.
With the social media companies. I was actually at that meeting.
Great.
So yes, I'm aware of the organization. We've had at least some contact with companies that are part of the forum, the counterterrorism forum, and so we're aware of it and have tried to, we've been working principally through the FBI to encourage them to address terrorist use of the internet.
You know, one thing that I think we're seeing here is that there isn't an institution in place for strong public-private partnerships as it pertains to social media, as far as we can see. Do you see any established public-private partnerships with social media? In other words, is there an institutionalized way for law enforcement to quickly and efficiently share information with social media companies or vice versa? Mr. McGarry, we'll start with you.
Well, there's absolutely a way to do it, and we do as far as sharing information. When we see threats, we will absolutely go through our private sector engagement offices within the FBI to do that. Specifically with the ACIPA process and give what the social media companies are wrestling with are different countries. So you have Europol, who's looking to put forth legislation from a European Union mindset. You have the U.S. and the First Amendment, and you have other countries. So they are trying to wrestle different terms of service in different parts of the world and what that means. So that, as they go through that. But we certainly, when we see something, we have within the counterterrorism division, we stood up an entire section we call strategic partnerships. That's to work with the banks, to work with the shippers, and to work with the social media companies.
Okay. Does anyone else have anything to add on that?
I would just say from under my office, as well as my knowledge of the process, we have a similar effort that we work in tandem with our partners here. In terms of outreach, we work every day to try to educate them on the threats and make sure that they have the information they need to make their private company decisions off of that.
Okay. Let's talk about 8chan. Is anyone aware of any direct outreach or communication with the owners of 8chan or the administrators? Have they contacted you? Mr. McGarry, we'll start with you.
I'm not aware of specific contact between the FBI and 8chan, but I can follow up and see. I'm sure.
Yeah, I mean, I'm especially concerned about this because all of this is based off relationships. We know that much of this is happening on 8chan, and if we have not had any direct contact with the administrators of 8chan, then I'm not sure what protocols we have in place to make sure that materials are taken off 8chan as quickly as possible.
Well, so certainly, First Amendment, we are prohibited from reviewing, looking at First Amendment activity. So if it's speech, if it's ideology, and it might be alarming as it is, we are prohibited from that. But our contact with 8chan on an operational side, if we are seeking something through judicial process or legal authority, I can get back to you on how much interaction there's been.
That'd be great, thank you. Mr. Murphy, do you have anything to add?
Sir, I'm not aware of, I'll have to get back to you to determine whether there's been contact or not.
Thank you. And lastly, ghost guns. None of you mentioned it directly in your testimonies. Is there anything you'd like to note particularly about ghost guns? Do you view this as a threat for the future, Mr. McGarry?
Ghost guns are certainly something we've briefed up within the counterterrorism division as well as the criminal division within the FBI. Is something that's concerning that you could have a weapon out there that's not traceable. Absolutely.
Right.
I would say from the department's perspective, we are tracking it and we have concerns about it, both from an infrastructure protection side, and the department is continually trying to refine its efforts to stay abreast of technology so that we don't have an adversary's ability to get whatever it's a ghost gun or whatever the weaponry is into infrastructure.
Fantastic. Mr. Rogan, is there anything else? All right. Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much. Chair recognizes the gentlelady from Nevada, Ms. Titus.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. When you're just about the end of the line, you get to hear everybody ask your questions, but I made a few points I want to go back over, if you don't mind. I've heard repeatedly that this is a collaborative effort, and I know that's the case with federal agencies, local law enforcement. I visited the Fusion Center in Las Vegas. It's so good not only at trying to prevent incidences, but reacting to instances like the shooting that occurred in my district, so I appreciate that. I also heard you talking about collaborating with the private sector. I would say that nobody does security in terms of expertise and technology better than the people in my district. The eye in the sky sees just about everything that goes on there, so I would encourage you to work with them as well, and I suspect you probably do. Going back to Mr. Katko's comments about say something, I know when that first came out, there was a lot of emphasis on it, a lot of excitement about it, but you admitted that that book was out of date, and we haven't seen much about it recently. I think we need maybe revisit that. I heard about a test not long ago where they, in Israel, they put a backpack under a seat in an airport, and within 2 minutes, somebody had seen it and reported it. They did the same thing under a seat in an airport in the U.S., and within 2 minutes, somebody had seen it and stolen it. So that's kind of what we're up against. So maybe we need a little more emphasis in this. One other thing was mentioned about the militia. I've heard the term sovereign citizens. They're anti-government. In fact, our Attorney General, Aaron Ford, said that they are probably the largest threat, domestic violence threat, in Nevada. And in my district alone, in Clark County, there are 500 identified people who belong to this kind of movement. I just wondered if you would address them, or is it the same as militia, or do you deal with them a little differently? One other thing is, I haven't heard mentioned animal cruelty. So often when you track people who have aberrant behavior and you see them on the internet, you see some evidence of real animal cruelty in their past. Do you have any way of overlaying this kind of information as you look for those red flags that have been mentioned? And finally, one form of domestic terrorism that hasn't been addressed is against abortion clinics and abortion doctors, and that seems to have been stepped up with the president's rhetoric that's just been very inflammatory and some outright lies. But a recent report said that providers had experienced 823 acts of trespassing, 1,700 acts of obstruction, 62 death threats, and 104 clinic blockades. Maybe you could address what y'all are doing in that area as well. Thank you.
So I think I can certainly start. So obviously, sovereign citizens, environmental rights, as well as animal right type cases, those extremist cases in that category, as well as abortion rights extremists, they are categories for us in our how we look at domestic terrorism. So to have that category, we absolutely are working those type cases. As far as the sovereign citizen extremist cases, obviously the harassment and targeting of law enforcement, government personnel is of concern. We do see those cases. We have a fair amount of those cases. When you look at the 850 total, a fair amount of them are sovereign citizen cases. And those are cases that certainly by differentiating themselves from the U.S. government, not abiding to the laws, certainly could become violent when confronted with law enforcement, whether it's serving a subpoena, a lien, or any judicial process. So certainly of concern, and certainly from the numbers, certainly something we're looking at. As far as animal rights, environmental rights extremists, certainly less on that. That threat has gone down in the sense of what we saw in years past. As far as organized groups doing things, we don't see as much from some of those groups you would think about from 15, 20 years ago. But from our sense, still a priority. In fact, we just did a transfer of custody from an environmental rights subject who's been on the lam for over 15, I think almost 20 years. We tracked him around the world into South America, Central America, and we brought him back from Cuba, of all places, to stand trial in Portland. So those type cases are very important for us. And the abortion extremist cases, obviously, whenever you're looking to, on either side of that issue, when you're looking to use violence to pursue your goal, it's of interest to us. We, again, may have less of those cases, but they're, once you get into the violence for us, you're into our realm, and that's where we're looking to disrupt you. So it doesn't matter on which side. If you're pushing violence to pursue your ideology, we're aggressively investigating you.
And very briefly, so yes, we mentioned before, it's in my written testimony, which has been submitted as well, that we're looking to build upon the suspicious reporting system of which started after 9/11. We have a new program. I've mentioned it before to the committee. We're happy to get with your staff and yourself and give you a full briefing on it. Specific to the Las Vegas Fusion Center, we have full-time folks there. We look forward to continuing supporting the Las Vegas Fusion Center and the work they're doing to look at violent behaviors. And in any way we can support that Fusion Center as a best practice, we're taking a look at that right now.
Thank you very much. Chair now recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Taylor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate you having this hearing. Wanted to go to a case that I know relatively well because it's close to my house. There was a Plano West high school student who was arrested last year. He had self-radicalized into Islam and had made plans to conduct an attack on a Hindu mosque in my community and then go attack a mall where I like to take my daughter to go ice skating. He was arrested. He was caught by the FBI, arrested. But then he was ended up being prosecuted, not by the Department of Justice, but by the Collin County District Attorney, because federal law does not allow prosecution of terrorists who are 17. And so he was actually sentenced, I believe, a few weeks ago in Collin County with a special prosecution, obviously, with the blessing of the FBI and the DOJ and their support in that prosecution. So my question to take that specific case, which is very close to my house, I drove past Plano West High School on the way to get to work here yesterday. Taking that personal or specific example to my community, what laws are getting in the way of you prosecuting terrorists that requires the state to step up and prosecute terrorists?
So without commenting on that specific case, juveniles under the federal system can sometimes be transferred to adult status, is my understanding. And so it's really in every case we're going to evaluate in the facts of the case, whether it's a DT case or less often an IT case, whether the best means of neutralizing the threat is a state charge or a federal charge. So it could be in the case you were talking about, the decision was discussion between the prosecutors at the state level and the federal level, and they said the state charge is actually the most effective way of dealing with this threat because they're going to get the longest sentence, or they're going to have flexibility, or based on the evidence, or whatever it might be, that the state charge is best. So that's a dialogue that occurs between state prosecutors and federal prosecutors, particularly on the domestic terrorism side. That's a frequent occurrence to have those discussions. So that's our overall approach. I don't know if that answers your question.
Sure. No, and let me just say, I have a lot of confidence in the district attorney in Collin County, Judge Willis. He does a great job. He's got a great team of prosecutors there, and obviously justice was done in that case. But my broader question is, what frailties exist in federal law now that make it so that you're literally looking to the state of Texas to prosecute a case rather than the Department of Justice?
So it really depends on the facts of the case as to whether an individual case is going to be prosecutable under federal law. Not every case on the domestic terrorism side, as we've talked about, we can use gun charges, we use explosive charges, we use threat and hoax charges. We can use hate crimes. There's a whole array of charges, but there could be a fact pattern. I don't know if the case you mentioned is one of them that doesn't meet the standards for any of those cases. So it falls between the cracks, and it might be a garden variety murder case. And it's easy to prove that murder offense under state law, but it doesn't qualify for any of the other things under federal law. And so they're going to bring that as a state case.
If you don't mind looking into this and seeing what frailties there are in federal statute where we're trying to go after terrorists and then end up, instead of doing it again, I think counterterrorism is truly a federal responsibility. I appreciate that sometimes our state partners are the right people to go do these things, and I know Judge Willis was glad to serve justice in this case, mm-hmm. but I wish we could, if you could look at that and then circle back with my team, I would like to have a further conversation in this committee about making sure that we bring terrorists to justice at the federal level. Let me just, I have a minute left, just wanted to go into another. So hate crimes under the FBI, there was a 17% increase 2017 over 2016. I also noticed that we have 1,000 more new law enforcement agencies reporting that kind of data to the FBI. So sometimes, in an effort to be more holistic and collect more data, you increase your numbers and then people say, oh, there's been an increase, but really, have you looked at what it would have been if you hadn't added those 1,000 agencies? In other words, is it just how we're collecting it, or is it because we're collecting more data, we have a bigger number? So it looks like there's an increase when actually there wasn't.
So from my vantage point, sir, under the counterterrorism division, I don't own the civil rights hate crimes. But I do know from hearing about it that obviously it's something we're doing more of, and more departments and their agencies are reporting it. So they want to give some time to see if there's actual increases or not due to the new data that wasn't there before. But again, that doesn't fall under the counterterrorism division where I work.
Have you gone back and re-looked at these numbers and excluded the 1,000 new agencies?
So that, again...
Is that possible? Is that an ask?
I don't know what they're doing on the criminal side of the FBI. I do know they are cognizant of the increase and determining whether it's just an increase in the data collection and the reporting, or is there actually an increase in hate crimes. I can't answer that. I just know it's an issue they're looking at.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you. Chair now recognizes the gentleman from New Jersey, Mr. Payne.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for having this this hearing. I'm going to hold this up for a second so everybody can get an idea. Mr. Murphy, are you acting undersecretary or are you the real deal?
I am the number two in terms of the intelligence enterprise. The undersecretary, Galawi, is in place.
But you're not acting.
I'm not acting.
No. And that makes two of you in the entire administration that's not acting, but that's for another day. Mr. Murphy, in early 2017, we learned that personnel in your office sent several emails concerning a document referred to as the race paper. Over a year ago, racial justice organizations filed a lawsuit against DHS to release the contents of the agency's memo referred in the government documents as the race paper. Thus far, only a completely redacted memo, which I just held up, of 9 pages has been released. Understandably, we're concerned that the DHS has a document which has not seen, we have not seen, called the race paper. Can you please describe the content of the race paper and to the extent possible?
Sir, thank you for the question. I am aware of the paper that you are talking about, and we follow the Freedom of Information Act to the letter. So everything we provide goes through our Privacy and Civil Liberties Office for release. Mm-hmm. With respects to, I think, the paper you're holding up, I will say that it was a draft of a paper was done by a very junior individual within our organization. The folks in the chain reviewed the paper, rightfully decided to not meet the parameters for publication, and the project was terminated. That paper, along with a lot of other drafts that our analysts review and try to bring out, they go through a very rigorous process before we hit send on that product and put our seal on it. I would note that within the...
Well, who requested the draft?
I'm sorry, sir?
How does the draft get created?
So all of our analysts look at the various threat lines that we are monitoring and have the latitude to help explain those threats. One of the issues I brought up in the beginning of this, of my testimony...
So there's a need for a race paper?
I don't think the email tagline that you're referring to is the way that I would characterize that draft paper.
How would you characterize it?
I would characterize a draft paper that, when it was reviewed by the first line supervisors, was killed.
Can DHS release an unredacted copy to members of Congress?
So we will continue to follow the FOIA regulations with respects to that. With the oversight responsibilities of Congress, we were happy to go back and I'll work with staff to see what is possible.
Okay. 2 years, 2 years after we've learned that the DHS had a secret document simply known as the race paper, Congress and the public still haven't seen the contents of this document. But we do know that some of the circumstances surrounding the release of the race paper, and they suggest that race is very concerning. For one thing, it was released in connection to a FOIA request related to the Black Lives Matter movement. Why would that be?
So, sir, the paper was never released?
Does the race paper include information on targeting individuals who peacefully protest against police violence or other racial injustice?
Sir, any paper that, as a professional, that I put my name on in the seal of the department goes through a rigorous process. I would also advertise that in the 17 intelligence agencies of the United States government, last year and as well as the year before, we were either number one or number two in terms of the quality of the information that the men and the women of my office put out. Part of that includes whether we reach the standards.
Okay, my time is coming to an end. Does the race paper suggest techniques for surveilling Black activists who protest against police violence?
So, sir, again, we don't have a race paper.
Well, this thing exists to some degree, whether it was a draft or whatever it was, somebody thought to do it, but my time is coming to an end. This is very troubling. I pledge my allegiance to a flag every single day that says that we all are created equal and are allowed to be citizens, and justice is meted out equally. This doesn't sound like this is the case, then I yield back.
The chair now recognizes the gentlelady from Florida, Ms. Demons.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for having this very important and timely hearing. Thank you to our witnesses for joining us today. Mr. Murphy, I'm directing my questions to you. As a former law enforcement officer, I certainly understand the importance of timely and appropriate information sharing, how important those intelligence reports are to local, particularly local law enforcement, in terms of helping them to plan and strategize for an appropriate response. Information, it's so valuable, it can really be a force multiplier for law enforcement agencies having to deal with oftentimes the unknown in their community. So I, first of all, want to thank you for the work that you are doing in that area to help those on the front line be adequately prepared. But however, there does, with the good work that you are doing, there still continues to appear to be some gaps in the process. And I am particularly concerned that information regarding white nationalist gangs and violent fringe right movement groups is not being shared with state and local law enforcement, even when they specifically seek it. And I know I missed the earlier discussions about trying to balance First Amendment rights, but of course we are also trying to keep our communities safe on every day. In November, the New York Times reported that the Gainesville Police Department, which is Gainesville is a city in Florida, was not provided relevant information leading up to the speech of Richard Spencer, a white nationalist whose public comments often ended in bloodshed. Of course, Gainesville is a college town. It's a short drive from my district in Orlando, but a police commander with that department said that the person had 24 years of experience, so knows the job very well, described the lack of information from the FBI and DHS as the Bermuda Triangle of intelligence. So unable to receive what he thought was appropriate or relevant useful information, he went online himself and did indeed find that the violent white nationalists had
who ultimately descended on the campus were not hiding. They were on social media networks, on message boards, talking about how they were going to test Florida's Stand Your Ground law. I eventually descended upon the city, opened fire on protesters. Thank God no one was killed that day, and they were ultimately arrested. But I would like to ask you, Mr. Murphy, what are the, as we balance First Amendment rights, and I certainly understand what the Constitution requires us to do, what are the lessons learned for you and your department as it pertains to events like the one in Gainesville and even the one that we're all familiar with, Charlottesville? And could you talk a little bit about how the department actively collects, reviews, and shares information specifically involving these type of groups?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you for the questions. So in my written statements and some of the charts I provided, we basically, one of the many things we do is run what's called the Homeland Security Network, or HISN Intel, and we have posted approximately 40,000 products on that that site. They're not just DHS products, they're state and local products. They are also the products of virtually every federal agency that does work in the domestic space, and we continually improve that site. Since 2016, that site has, and the quality of products we're putting on there has increased, and we know that by measuring it in a couple of different ways. One is the metrics is that we've increased the volume by approximately 64%. We also look at how often and what actual products are reviewed. And so we've seen approximately 325% increase in the number of views. And then we ask for metrics back from and qualitative and quantitative responses from our colleagues, which is exclusively state and local law enforcement, is do these products matter? And we see the products get upwards of about a 90% approval rating. All that said, that's just one technical fix. We're also mindful that we have to continually advertise that this exists to state and local colleagues. As people change, they're coming out, they're busy. We want to make sure it's as user-friendly, and we provide it as often as we can. We've increased the number of our field.
Well, these were lessons learned in terms of sharing of information post-Gainesville, post-Charlottesville, or were these processes in place prior to those events but somehow failed?
I would say, ma'am, that they've been ongoing since 9/11 on forward. And so we continue to learn from all information sharing experiences that we have. We've increased the number of personnel that we're deploying to the field since 2016. Again, they're not in response to specifically to the two incidences that you described, but we certainly understand the importance of deploying our personnel so they have that firsthand experience in exposing and hearing back from our state and local colleagues what they need. In response to your question, there's not a day that goes by that I challenge my entire team to make sure that any classified information reporting from other agencies, we encourage those agencies to get out that information to our state and local colleagues. We don't get pushback. I think it's just awareness in my experience with the interagency writ large. The last thing I'll just say to this is it's a continuing effort that we need to make, and we strive every day to push that along. We engage in virtually every state and local organizational meeting that's out there, and we look forward to continuing those. I know most of the leadership on a first-name basis, and I will continue to try to make myself, and I know my boss, the Undersecretary, will, and our staff enjoys those experiences, and we learn quite a bit how we can help out our state and local colleagues.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Chair. Now recognize the gentleman from California, Mr. Correa.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you very much for having this most important hearing. As you know, the increase in domestic terrorism is alarming. Last year, I called for a hearing immediately after the Charlottesville and Pittsburgh Domestic Terrorism Acts. None were held, and that's why I thank you for doing this today. Gentlemen, this last week, I was back home, and I held private town halls for the Jewish community and the Muslim communities in my district. since Poway was right down the street from us, so to speak, these issues hit home for all of us. Speaking to my local school district, constituents lived around my local high school that I attended. A lot of constituents are upset because the high school is building a fence around the school that makes it look like a prison. When I talked to the administrators, they said, Lou, this is about safety. Not only are we putting in a fence around most of our schools, we're also putting in hundreds of cameras, all of our schools. We've gotten to a bad situation in society where our fear for domestic terrorism, people that might live in our own communities, we're afraid of. And the biggest challenge is going after the lone wolves, the folks that you just can't figure out what triggers that act of hate that leads to deaths. And of course, my prayers go out to the families in Colorado that suffered in the last few hours. My question to you gentlemen is, how are we working with the locals? In Orange County, Sheriff Barnes has a fusion center. OA says, we're doing some great job, Lou, but we need more resources. We need more resources to track the lone wolves. What is it that we can do? What is it that we need to do to go after these domestic terrorists? Because I get a sense from everything that I hear that we're very focused on foreign terrorists and that our resources are going there. But yet when you look at the carnage in our society today, it's the domestics that are really hurting us. Those domestic terrorists are the ones that are changing our lives, how we act, how we behave, and how we invest our resources. My school district, instead of going for books and teaching, a big chunk of that money is now going to building fences, putting in cameras, and try to figure out where to put those security guards. Give me your thoughts. How do we harden our society? How do we go after these lone wolves?
So, I think you characterized the threat that in the state that we're in. I will tell you, on the domestic terrorism side, we arrest more people per year, at least the last 2 years that I've looked back, than international terrorism. More people arrested that are domestic terrorism subjects than international terrorism subjects.
But are we putting enough resources domestically, or are most of our resources still going to the foreign terrorism?
No, I mean, if you look at our case numbers, and our case numbers rely on tips from the community, our law enforcement partners, our analysis from within to see if someone is talking to someone, all those things. 50% come from the community, state, or local, as far as our injects.
So does our investment, our expenditure reflect that? You talk about cases, you talk about arrests, about dollars spent. Are we spending enough on local?
I don't split the difference between international terrorism and domestic terrorism when we have agents in the field working their cases. There might be a budget line item somewhere within our books back here for travel and stuff, but it's the same. It's agents going.
I'm glad to hear that you're not splitting it based on that, but clearly there's got to be a focus on where the danger is coming from.
Well, I think you said it. The lone actor is the problem set that we're dealing with. Insular in nature, non-conspiratorial, not necessarily being directed or engaging with others. So you have lone offenders, lone actors. Very hard to detect from a law enforcement perspective, whether you're state, local, or FBI. Certainly for the FBI, we rely on sources. We rely on working with our Joint Terrorism Task Force and our task force partners to do that. But we will, time and time again, we said it here before, see something, say something. It's likely an individual, maybe a family member, more specifically, a religious leader, a teacher, that will see a change in behavior, see a triggering event where they see an individual become radicalized quickly and mobilized to violence. We need that person to speak up and tell us.
I'm out of time. One quick follow-up. Offline, I'd like to talk to you a little bit more about how we continue to refocus on those specific issues, work with the local fusion centers to make sure that we're able to track down some of those folks that may blow up in our society before they blow up. Mr. Chair, I yield.
Thank you very much. And we join you in your interest in pursuing that, too. Chair recognizes the gentlelady from Texas, Ms. Jackson Lee.
Again, Mr. Chairman, let me thank you, along with the ranking member, for this important committee. If my recollection serves me well, under your leadership, certainly as ranking member and as members of this committee, we have championed or cried out for help and relief from the growing proliferation of domestic terrorism. It breaks my heart on the amazing silence we've had to encounter and the loss of life. So let me first of all join Mr. Payne. I'd like to ask whoever has the document, the race paper, to release it in its entirety. I know that we do have the Black Identity Extremist Report. So let me pursue a line of question. I just need, and first of all, let me thank you, gentlemen, for your commitment to the safety and security of the American people. We always are proud of those who offer themselves to serve. Let me ask you the question of your knowledge of the importance of a bully pulpit for good reasons. And you just have to, importance of a bully pulpit, Mr. Murphy, is it yes or no important on good comments that can go, that can be far reaching?
I believe so, yes, ma'am.
Mr. McGarrity?
I don't think I understand the question.
The use of the bully pulpit for a good reason, is that a positive thing?
Yes, anyone advocating for something good, I would say is positive.
And the next witness, Mr. Murphy?
Wigman, I agree.
Thank you. And I agree as well. So let me be very clear. The President of the United States has not done enough to deal with quashing the rising acceleration of domestic terrorism and hate in this country. He has a very important responsibility. He heads the government. He gives guidance to the Department of Justice under the Attorney General. And there has not been enough done. In fact, we see in the last decade, domestic terrorism become an increasing concern in the United States. In 2018, domestic extremists killed at least 50 people in the U.S., a sharp increase from 37 extremist-related murders in 2017. It goes on to show how many were in 2015 and 2016, 70 and 72. Right-wing terrorists between 2010 and 2017 committed a third of all acts of domestic terrorism in the U.S., 92 out of 263. The ACLU and the Southern Poverty Leadership Group has indicated that hate crimes have moved up exponentially. Now, let me correct the record. I understand that previously it was indicated that the individual who did the dastardly act in Baton Rouge was a Black identity extremist. I understand he was a separatist, but he's also a member of the sovereign nation. So the question is, are we still blaming and using the terminology Black identity extremist? Anybody has an answer for that?
I can say from the FBI, we haven't used that term since I've been here in 15 months.
So I don't want
to prep for the briefings.
And I thank you very much. I don't want to point specifically to the exclusion of other hate groups, but I do believe it is important to focus on the rising emphasis of white nationalism and Nazism. They are glaringly in the limelight, starting from Dylan in Mother Emanuel, who professed that ideology, going to the Coast Guard individual that's right in the mix right now, that is frankly having attacked or at least attempted to attack various public figures, to the gentleman professing his love for Trump in Florida, attacking members of Congress, and to Charlottesville. My question is, when is the president to emphasize to the Attorney General and to each and every one of you that your major and chief responsibility, besides all the technical things that we have to do, is dealing with white nationalism and Nazism? I'm asking all three of you that question.
I can take it. The first part, I can just highlight, as far as domestic terrorism, I can tell you it is
white nationalism and Nazism. Please use that terminology. I understand they're understandable.
So from the National Security Strategy for Counterterrorism this year, which was put out, obviously it highlights violent extremism such as racially motivated extremism, and that normally domestic terrorism in the United States is on the rise. That's That's a statement, but obviously that's a strategy. What's going to be done to implement it? I can tell you the National Security Council with the National Counterterrorism Center and DHS and the FBI are now working towards an implementation plan on that strategy, as well as the rest of the United States intelligence community. So it's actually in the strategy, first time in years that I know of, that it's in domestic terrorism is actually highlighted in the strategy. As far as what we're being directed to do, like anything, we're being directed to preempt violent attacks by people who have an ideology that are trying to pursue whatever that ideology is, and that's been our mandate.
So may I just make an inquiry to you, Mr. Chairman, because the other gentlemen were not able to answer. I'd like to have their answers in writing if I'm not able to hear it at this point. But I would ask the committee, if we could, to ask, secure a specific request. I know that Mr. Garrity, have great respect for all of them, specific request for their plan to move quickly on the issues of white nationalism and Nazism in terms of a response to those particular issues, keeping in mind everyone's right to the First Amendment. And I would appreciate if those gentlemen could either answer or they could provide it in writing to the chair.
I'm happy to answer, which is from a DOJ perspective, absolutely we're committed. As I said in my opening testimony, it was made clear today, regardless of the motivation of the threat, if it's white supremacy, if it's white nationalism, if it's any other kind of threat, we're absolutely committed, working with FBI, working with our colleagues at DHS, to investigate, prosecute those cases. Some of the ones you mentioned are cases that we have prosecuted, and those are mentioned in my opening testimony. So again, we're absolutely committed to addressing that threat.
Ma'am, I'm happy to answer now as well, and it's in my statements as well. You know, we don't base how we pursue individuals who are pursuing violence or pursuing grievances solely based on ideology, that, as you noted, is First Amendment. But those that seek to harm citizens or anyone in the world based on whatever the motivation is and there's violence involved, we certainly go after that on a daily basis and we'll continue to do that. I think our numbers in the overall domestic terrorism space bear that out. Since 2016, the amount of reporting we've put out on it has sharply increased, approximately 40%, and we look forward to working with all of our partners here to continue that reporting. I would also add that we work aggressively with the faith-based community and with our partners here to make sure where they happen to be a target, we can give them those resources they need, as well as other community coalitions that are out there. And we look forward to continuing to do that.
Thank you.
Thank you for your courtesy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Green.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank the ranking member, and I thank the witnesses for appearing. Dear friends, as witnesses, if you are familiar with, and I believe you are, I just want to build the record. If you're familiar with the KKK, would you kindly extend a hand into the air? I believe you are. Let the record reflect that all are. And are you familiar with their cross burning? They call it cross lighting. If you're familiar with them, I'm sure that you know that they do. Would you kindly raise a hand? All hands are in the air for the record. And is it true that, they use this as a means of symbolizing their faith? They claim to be Christians, the members of the Klan. And in burning or lighting the cross, they are exemplifying their faith. I believe as persons familiar with the Klan, doing the kind of work that you do, you probably know this too, but let me just ask you to raise your hands if you know this. Raise your hands, please. Okay, all hands. Now, have we ever called, have you any information wherein it has been widely said that when a Klansman commits an act of terrorism, that this was Christian terrorism? Has that ever been widely used, Christian terrorism? If the answer is no, do not raise a hand. No hands are up. So it has not been widely used. We do know that if persons of the Islamic faith commit an act of terrorism, there's a commonly used term, Islamic terrorism. Have you heard this term, Islamic terrorism? If so, would you raise your hand, please? All have raised their hands. I'm putting you through this exercise because it seems to me that there is a mindset that has to be dealt with. When white men calling themselves Christians commit acts of terrorism, we don't define it as such. We don't say Christian terrorism. But if a person who is of the Islamic faith does it, we connect the faith to the violence. I don't think that the Klan is a Christian organization. I'm the grandson of a preacher. I know that they don't live up to the tenets of Christianity. Then I don't think that those persons who are of the Islamic faith who may commit some violent act or who claim they are, I don't really think that that's Islam. So I'm mentioning this to let you know that we have a problem in terms of our mindset that we have to deal with. Next point quickly, and I'll tie it all together. If I said there were some very fine people among the bigots, the racists, the Klansmen in Charlottesville, that there were some very fine people among them, would that be an appropriate thing for a member of Congress to say? If you think so, raise your hand. Let the record reflect that no one has raised a hand. So if the president says it, some very fine people among those who were preaching, Jews will not replace us, blood and soil. The president says it. Is it appropriate for the president to say such a thing? If you think that it is not appropriate, raise your hand. If you think it's not appropriate for the president to say what you just said would be inappropriate for a member of Congress to say, if you think it's not appropriate for the president to say there were some fine people among those folk in Charlottesville where a person lost her life, raise your hand. You think it's inappropriate for the president to say it? Raise your hand.
Sir, if I may, at least from the DHS perspective, I think the way we look at it and the way we go after these...
Excuse me, please. I greatly appreciate your perspective, but I'm limited on time. So you were quick. You had no problem saying that members of Congress should not use such language. But you refuse to acknowledge that the president should not use such language?
If I could just jump in.
Yes, quickly, please.
I would say for me personally, it's just not up my place as a career government official to comment on what either members of Congress or the president.
Well, you already did. But too late now, see.
Okay, well.
You already did. You already said that it's inappropriate for members of Congress. But when it gets to the president.
I don't think I commented one way or the other.
You did. You're on the record. Okay. You raised your hand. You're on the record. Here's the point. We who hold public trust have to have the same standard for everyone. Same standard for the KKK that we have for persons who claim to be of the Islamic faith. Same standard for, and they are not, same standard for the president that we have for members of Congress. If you can't uphold the same standard, you're doing your country a disservice, my friends. I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you very much. Let me thank the witnesses for their valuable testimony today. I'd like a couple of items inserted in the record. One is a compendium of letters from 2011 to 2018 asking for hearings before this committee on domestic terrorism. Just for the record. Mr. Garrity, we've been made aware that on March 19th, a number of civil rights groups, NAACP, Leadership Conference, a number have requested a meeting with the FBI director. And some, up until this day, the letter has not even been acknowledged. And I think part of their interest is around this whole effort of domestic terrorism. And we want to instill confidence in all our law enforcement people. But we also recognize the fact that organizations who are interested in this issue should not be ignored. So I'd like to provide you with a copy of this letter for you to share with the director and ask him to engage those organizations who wrote him in good faith for an opportunity to discuss this issue of domestic terrorism with him. And I'd also like to include a copy of the letter for this hearing. Without objection, again, let me thank you for your participation and the members who actually, overall, most of them came and had questions. The members of the committee may have additional questions for the witness, and we ask that you respond expeditiously in writing to those questions. Without objection, the committee record shall be kept open for 10 days. Hearing no further business, the committee stands adjourned.